morning, and welcome to the pre-show show. Brian, would you like to say good morning?
Hello. Hello.
There we are.
Hello.
Good. Everyone has said good morning. Now, we've come up with a new mouth-warming exercise this morning, everybody. It is to say the words chief, threshing, shrew, with speed and understanding. Chief, threshing, shrew. It's not easy, not a shoe, a shrew. Shrew. Shrew, as an elephant shrew. Like a mousy thing with a long nose. Chief threshing shrew. Chief threshing shrew. Chief threshing shrew. Chief threshing shrew. And what I do know is happening now is that Rebecca is trying to do it in the final control and having a giggle. Chief threshing shrew. 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 Black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket, black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket.
Black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket.
Black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket.
Black leather jacket,
yellow leather jacket.
Black leather jacket, yellow leather jacket.
Yes, let's rap. I'm keen. Morning rap.
Ready?
I'm ready.
Here we go. Make sure you're ready.
I'm ready. It's a chilly morning out here in the morning. There's a cloud in the sky. It might rain on us. Water might fall from the sky on my face and drip down my face down into my lap. And it's not nice to drive with water in your lap, because then your underpants become wet. When your underpants are wet, it's time to go home and have breakfast. Breakfast, eggs are for breakfast. Breakfast, breakfast, eggs are for breakfast. Maybe some toast and a little coffee, because you've got a wet underpants. There's an impala with a broken horn. Broken, broken horn. Don't fight over ladies, you will get a broken horn. If you fight over ladies, you will get a broken horn, and it will be so ow.
Oh,
very nice.
Very nice.
I like the way that we covered a number of topics.
Yes, it was quite.
Breakfast, fighting over ladies, and the weather.
Wonderful.
And getting a wet underpants. Yes.
That one should always try and avoid.
One should never have a wet underpant.
No.
Now, if you are wondering what on earth these two complete imbeciles talking to you are doing, we are doing the pre-show show. This is so that you know we are live. Now,
yes. Can you say hello?
Yes. Say hello, Brian.
Hello.
Brian, tell us how you slept, because I don't think it was very well, was it?
I slept kind of like this, sometimes like that.
Very nice.
Wasn't great.
No.
Wasn't good. Hang on, what's going on here?
Brian doesn't sleep very well, everyone.
I sleep like rubbish most days.
Yes. I, of course, slept like a baby. Except for the clouds of mosquitoes. I must just tell you, everybody.
Did you not hear a massive crash in the night?
I did. I thought Wildebeest had been attacked in his room by a buffalo.
Yeah.
Where is your baby?
Where is your baby?
Please make your baby for us today.
There is the baby.
It is there. Brian, you said today for babies. Ah, she's having a little pregnancy yoga stretch.
Wonderful.
I meant to tell you, you need to click subscribe or the bell next to subscribe so that your phone goes bang when we go live.
Yeah, nice pang sound.
Like a bang!
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 Bang! Oh, Safari Live! Bang!
Bing! Oh, Safari Live's got a sighting. Bang! Right, we're going to say goodbye to you now and see you later with some sanity. Yes, in the next 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. You're out of here.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
What a way to start a sunset drive with Nkuhuma Pride. And this is Safari Live. From Juma Private Game Reserve, it's again another windy day. Now, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me this morning, we've got David. There he is. Now, as you saw, we do have the lions, except we've got one problem, is that they're going towards the Juma Pan. Now, I don't think the guests that are staying in Vuyatela have woken up just yet, so we're going to have to be quite sneaky as to how we view them. But let's hope Aubrey or Taxon, or no, Rexon and Taxon wake up quickly. Oh, hang on, I'm going to go right forward because they're having a drink. I'm just going to go over this log quickly. It's a big jumping log, that one. There we go, that's a better view. Here we go, just stopping for a quick drink today. And you won't believe all the things that they managed to get up to last night. We had reports from Brent and Jamie saying that they heard a whole lot of commotion going on. And I believe that the lionesses attempted to take down a hippo. But unfortunately, they were not successful. I think they bit off a bit more than they could chew. As we know, that young male hippopotamus that's in the pan, well, he's quite fit and he's quite strong, and I think he put up a good fight. Now, I haven't seen all the lionesses just yet. I've only seen three or four. Well, just, is there two up on the bank there, or is it just the one? It's just the one. So we've only got three lionesses here. And I did hear a male roaring about 30 minutes ago or so. So I wonder where the rest of the pride is. Perhaps they're still on the that carcass and where they were in that drainage line yesterday afternoon. But we'll go and do a bit of investigating a little bit later. But there's one lioness that's contact calling. So perhaps she is waiting for the rest of the pride to respond. Now remember, we are currently on a live safari and we would love to hear from you this morning. So if you've got any questions for us, please send them through. You can either hashtag Safari Live or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. And well, James, myself and Steph, well, we'd be honored to really chat with you. And it's quite nice. It's nice and cool here this morning. So I think that these lions may be on the move for quite some time. But it seems as though they're going to make the walk across the dam wall. So we'll have to try and find a sneaky way to try and cross around here, which could be exciting. Well, how do you feel about that today? Hey, David?
Sounds good.
Do a little bit of an excursion and try and get around to the other side. Let me count the cubs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think they're all here. Right. Now, I think I can count all of the cubs, but we'll have another look when they seem to bunch up together. But Steph has finally headed out on foot now that the sun is starting to rise, and I know that he'd like to say good morning.
Good morning. And there, running off in the distance, was a herd of Nyala followed by a very amorous bull Nyala. I'm Stefan Winterboer. Good morning to you, everybody. It's a blustery day out here. And, well, we've got VM on camera today. He's looking forward to the bushwalk as much as what I am. And what is our plan? I don't know. I walked out onto quarantine this morning after the sun came up. The wind is absolutely howling where we are at the moment. It is predicted to do this the whole day and bringing with it some rain this afternoon, and I think what we can see is this band of clouds that is coming in quite low, scudding in over the horizon, And will very, very soon, I feel, probably blot out the blue sky and blot out the sun for us. So, without further ado, I think we're going to try and miss those lions, which are not drinking too far from where we're standing at the moment. Probably only about 200 yards or so, just on the other side of this thicket that we're standing next to. So we're going to carry on, put our heads into the wind, and see what we can find this morning. I must be honest, I had a pretty awesome evening. I came to the realization that what we did yesterday, and for those of you who are just joining us now for the first time, yesterday we managed to follow a greater honey guard. And the honey guard, after about an hour and a half of chittering madly from tree to tree, led us to a African honeybee hive. And at the time I was very excited. I mean, I'd never successfully followed a honey guard in 20 years of guarding, or just less than 20 years of guarding. You hear about it so often, but it's so often not seen or not concluded. And I just want to say that probably from a filming point of view, or capturing it on camera, live and with an audience like yourselves, that was probably one of the very, very few recorded archives of a successful African or greater honey guard and human interaction. That's it's a profound thing. I've been thinking about it since I basically went to sleep last night. And it's been quite a nice thing. Very exciting, to be quite honest. Wow, the wind today is hectic. I don't quite know if it's gonna, it feels like it storms, it feels like it's, well, we'll see. We'll definitely know what's gonna happen by the time the walk is finished. Alrighty, now we're going to send you back over to James. I think he's got something to show you. It sounded like he had an elephant, but the wind is blowing so hard in my big ears, I couldn't really hear.
We have a little herd of elephants here, everybody. Good morning, first of all. I forgot I did the pre-show show, so I haven't actually said good morning to you. Hello. Hello, Brian.
Hello.
Well, we have to remember now we're not in the pre-show show. This is very serious. Very nice. Hashtags for our live questions are wildwith.tv. Please do talk to us during the course of the morning. Here are some elephants. This one is very curious about us. Looks like, well, it's definitely an elephant cow. A very small herd, just three of them. And she's roughly the same age as our favourite elephant cow, the one with the bottom third of her trunk missing. And I thought it might be her until I just saw her trunk. That's the long floppy bit on the front, isn't it, Brian?
It is.
Yes. As opposed to the sharp pointed white bit that you need to watch out for. Yes. So it's a lovely morning out here. Well, it isn't, it is lovely, but it's kind of apocalyptically lovely. There's a grey cloud, there's quite a chilly wind blowing, the sun has come up through some scudding grey skies. And I think we're in for a quite interesting day weather-wise. Just a tiny little breeding herd of elephants, three of them only. And they're completely relaxed, which is marvellous. It is Sunday, of course, and that is why elephants are relaxed. They don't have to go to work today, Brian.
Yes. Mm. The day of the Lord.
Indeed. Look at the length of her eyelashes. That is astounding. I have never seen that before. They're about 8 inches long on the one side. And show us the other side. Come on. Come on. No. Right, let's just roll gently down the road after them. Oh. Right, apparently the lions are being slightly more cooperative than these elephants, so let's go back to them and have a look.
Isn't this just the most incredible view you've seen of these lions? Well, in my case, I think it's fantastic they've decided to sit themselves up on the dam wall. Now, we're sitting in the drainage line below them, sort of on the other side of the big pan. And it's amazing how it allows for us to actually see them down below. It's not always an angle that you usually get. And it's really beautiful as they walk across this wall. So we're going to get a few more of the lionesses. Let's see what's happening now. Something's caught her attention. And I'm not sure where the other two have gone, if they're hanging back with the rest of the cubs. But what we may have to do is actually go up this drainage line wall and try and find a way to get, well, to the top. Because if they disappear any further west, well, we're not going to really be able to see them because we're so low down. Now, little cubs, you better be careful not to play on this wall because it's a far tumble down to the bottom. That's good. That looks like... Is that little floppy ear sitting in the middle? Could be. More, I'm not sure. Like I said, I think that ear is going to heal up quite nicely if it is her, but we'll have a look. Is it? Yes, it is. You see what I mean, how I say, as soon as that swelling starts to disappear on her, her ear is going to go back to normal, and that is indeed our little floppy-eared girl. What are we... We're not going to really be able to give her the nickname Floppy Ear, unfortunately, because she's not going to have a floppy ear, and I hope we're going to be able to keep telling the difference between her and the rest of the cubs. Well, I'm sure her personality will actually just shine through. So we should be all right there. Right, let me just call the sighting in now that the guides are starting to drive. Good morning, I've got the Nkuhuma Pride. They're currently sitting on the dam wall east of Weatelapan. It's just myself here. I'm in the drainage line on the eastern side. It's just myself.
I'll be joining you shortly. I'm just approaching the dam wall from the other side.
Okay, copy, Rex. You'll be number two. Here you go. Rex is coming to join us. Hello, little cubs. Here you go, going to say hello. And you can see them as they're walking. They're also looking and watching and making sure they don't get too close to that edge. But they seem to be a little bit on the chilly side today. You can see how they keep curling themselves up. Oh, did you get your tail sat on? And I wonder what they're going to get up to today. Oh, that's beautiful. That is so stunning. Ideally, it would be really lovely if we had a blue sky behind us, but I suppose we can't have everything. This is the privilege just to be sitting here with Nkuhumas first thing in the morning. Sitting like a real prince, watching the birds. Couple of starlings that were flying around that are sort of catching the attention of the cubs. Oh, that's so beautiful. They can't help themselves but walk past and play with each other, whether it's a little tap or whatever it may be. There's a bit of blue sky coming out now. That's good for us. It means, oh well, I don't know. The clouds are actually moving in quite quickly. We will see what the day holds for us. Hopefully we get a bit of rain a bit later. You do not look very impressed this morning. She doesn't look like she's friends with any of her siblings at the moment. Not her playful self. Yeah, what we're going to do now is we need to reposition, and I think, I don't know where we're going to go up because it's a very steep bank here. I think we're actually going to have to go back around again. Well, maybe we can find a little, let's see. Which way? So do we need to go in here? Okay. Right, David seems to think to know where there's a little pathway. Right, so we're going to go and find the little pathway and then jump on it and make our way back around to the lions. But while we do that, let's go back across to Steph.
Taylor's trying to find a pathway. We're trying to stay out of the window here. I tell you, it's blustery. What is quite nice is the fact that these white berries on the white berry bush are starting to get quite large at the moment. You can see... They will probably get about double to three times the size, and then we will be able to eat them. But on this particular bush, and what drew me to it, is the fact that it's still got some flowers. That's as large as what its flower is, here next to my thumbnail. Tiny little things. But they emit a very powerful and lovely smell. Not quite citrusy, but not quite jasmine-y, a sort of jasmine citrus smell. I must be honest, very lovely. And I'm looking forward to these particular white berries. They come out in the next 3 or 4 weeks, they'll be ripe, and then every bush out here is just covered in them, and you can walk around and have your pick of what breakfast snack you decide to have, much to VM's delight, as I know he quite enjoys his snacks. Now, what else I'm looking for inside here is any caterpillars that we can find that are busy eating the leaves of these particular bushes. Now, this time of year, early spring, as soon as there's this burst of green leaf color, is when the caterpillars come out, just before we get to deep summer, where all the we're just covered by butterflies and covered by moths. It's quite an interesting thing. Quite often these caterpillars display a wide variety of coloration, defense mechanisms, camouflage, eating behavior. They're all these weird and wonderful colors, and that's of course quite exciting for this time. But no caterpillars just yet. What we do have is a lonely Polyrhynchus ant. These ants here, James, we discovered, well, I was shown them by a friend of mine years ago, and I showed James this particular ant. These ants forage singularly. They don't forage in groups. They're looking for almost anything that they can catch. You can see that ant. A bit difficult to follow here. I'm just trying to see if we can stop him for you to have a look at. They have this sort of matte black color. And often by the local Shangaan people like Herbert, they call them lemon ants. And that's because they have quite a lot of formic acid that they use as a bit of a defense strategy, but we use as a bit of a snack as well, a bush snack. They have the most tart lemon flavor that bursts in your mouth when you eat them. Now, I'm not going to eat that poor fellow. He's just not doing anyone any harm. But if you were wanting a little bit of a breath freshener, or if you're wanting a little bit of a tart snack, or a mouth cleanser, I should say, these ants are lovely to pick up. Now, they have the most interesting nest, and I want to see if we can actually find it. Generally, they have their nests at the base of these trees, but what they do is they actually thatch the entrance to their nests. Yes, thatch it. So they take bits and pieces of grass and they weave this mat around the entrance to their nests, and that stops rain from eroding the edges of the nest and creating the sand, basically the sandfall effect that rain will have. So they thatch the entrance to their nest. Now these, they don't forage at nighttime, they forage during the day. I'm almost sure if we just open up our eyes here a little bit, we will actually find the nest. Let me go around that side of the tree. I'm coming around that side again, Viv. Their nests are usually at the base of these trees, and because of that thatched effect, actually quite well hidden. But let's see if we can actually find one for you. I won't spend too much time looking. It'll be very boring for you to watch me forage through the undergrowth here. See if we can find one today for you. But what I did find, and another Polyrhynchus ant inside here. There's this giant land snail shell which has been stepped on probably by a buffalo, and you can see that inside it gives us a unique sort of look inside there. Now, we find these shells lying around in the bush quite often, and they last for a long time. So over a series of seasons, they'll lose their coloration, and they'll also be bleached nice and white by the sun. And what usually kills them are the larvae of fireflies, basically. Glowworms, Lampyridae. The larvae are carnivorous on snails, and quite often will feed on giant land snails. You can imagine it's a fantastic meal. So what would happen is the larvae of a firefly is a spiky, vicious-looking worm, crawls along until it finds one, latches itself onto the snail, injects the snail with a neurotoxin, which disables the snail. The snail sort of becomes paralyzed. And generally what happens is the snails realize something's wrong and they sort of move to a bush. They then don't die at the bush. The firefly larvae takes a long time to eat a snail like this. So what the larvae does is inject this neurotoxin, paralyzes the snail, and then feeds. What comes out of that are two things. The female glowworm, so the females are called glowworms, they don't have any wings, and the males are called fireflies. The female glowworm will come out of the snail, climb up onto a bush, and signal her, I suppose her desire would be a thing, they'd signal out to some flashes. The male that's flying around sees those flashes and then comes down to the female, their mate, and the cycle starts all over again. Fantastic, eh? Anyway, after that, and with us carrying on into the wind, we're going to send you over to James.
Well, we're sitting here on the northern boundary of Arethusa, everybody, and we're looking into Simbambili. Shh, don't tell anyone, you're not allowed to do that. And there are some zebra there eating the fresh green grass on the firebreak between the two cut lines, or the two roads that separate Arethusa from Simbambili. Now, if you are a new viewer, welcome especially. And Simbambili, if you're wondering, is the reserve to the north of Arethusa, which is to the west of Juma, which is where we call home. It's all deeply confusing, but we traverse three reserves, one called Juma, one called Arethusa, one called Cheetah Plains. They're all completely unfenced from each other. It's just human property laws that mean we can't traverse everywhere we want to. The animals can come and go as they please, as the zebra are. And they are loving the new grass there. And I think they're quite a nice colour. If you look at the green around them and the swaying branches in this very strong southeaster. It has an ominous feel to it this day, doesn't it, Brian? And you'll find that grazers like this will move from termite mound to termite mound. And that's because the grass, of course, around the termite mounds, we know, is that much more nutritious than the others. And so if you were to follow them, if you were to track them, you'd probably find them moving from one mound to the other, grazing as they go. Now, James, you're wondering about the rain and how much we got last night. Well, for those of us who don't hear things in our sleep, no rain at all. There was no rain at all. Kirsten, of course, dreams of rain on a nightly basis, and she said even for her there was no rain last night. So interestingly, not even a virtual drop. There was some wind, there was some lightning. I must also tell you that the greatest noise in the night came from Viam's room. It was nothing untoward. We thought maybe he'd been attacked by a buffalo in his room. That wasn't what happened. His shelf detached itself from the wall and came crashing down. Those were the only sounds of the night. You can see the wind is very strong indeed. The zebras are very happy though. The radio is completely silent in my ear, so either it isn't working or there's not much else to see. I'm going to sneak forward, Brian. There's quite a nice arrangement of zebra in front there. They're all grazing in a line, and of course, zebras arranged in a line is very artistic. Isn't it, Brian?
It is.
So artistic.
So wonderful.
So wonderfully artistic. There were four of them, and now they are afraid, and they are moving away. That is not very artistic of you, four zebras. No. That's it. That's it. That's it. Very nice. Look at us. Gorgeous. I must say, I do think on a day like this, when the sky is the colour that it is, it's not difficult for them to kind of melt into the bush in order to avoid being eaten by lions. And interestingly, at the moment, the lion, of course, we know, are specialising in devouring buffalo. They did apparently have a go at a hippo last night, but clearly failed. And the zebra seemed to be relatively unmolested. They kind of go about life, and the lions, other than for the very little ones, seem to pay them not much heed. Now, unlike those buffalo, of course, the zebra have got the ideal muzzle to eat the short grass there. You can see that muzzle just sort of moving away the bits that it doesn't want and then collecting the bits that it does. And then, of course, two very sharp sets of incisors on the top and bottom that help it to crop that short grass. Now, a buffalo is unable to do that. They do not have top incisors at all, much like most of the ruminants. And that means that they must use their tongues, and their tongues are just not adapted to grazing the very short grass like that. Also, I think quite interestingly, and unlike a goat or a pig, you will see that the zebra just sort of mow the lawn there. They don't pull the plants out of the ground. They use their very sharp teeth, and that means, of course, they leave grazing behind. Now, if you watch a warthog or a goat or an impala grazing sometimes, you'll often see them, they grab the plant and pull it out. And that, I mean, it has its other sort of ecological benefits, I suppose, for the system, but the zebra are rather good at maintaining a lawn. Very clever of them. Oh, now, Big Blue, I think I know the answer to this question, but I'm going to put it out there to all of you. You say, what are those round scabs on the inside of the knee? Or the, it's not the knee, it's the sort of wrist joint. There we go, well spotted, Brian, on the zebra. Now, that on a horse, everyone, is known as the chestnut. And I was told once, and whether this is true or not, I'm not sure, that the chestnut in the fetus is actually attached, so the two front legs are stuck together in an attempt, we think, to stop the baby zebra or baby horse kicking too much in the mother's womb. And so the legs are kind of stuck together at the wrists like that. And if I think that's what they're for, but if anybody has a better idea as to what they're for, I'd be very interested to know. It's definitely called the chestnut. What its function is, I'm not convinced. Oh, I heard a story like that when I was a very young boy. Of course, I'm not a young boy anymore, am I, Brian? And so it may or may not be true. Right, while we move on, Stefan seems to have found something small in a container.
I've got such an awesome surprise here for you. I have had to pick them up because they were running away. But I have two male Bushveld rain frogs here for you. Just have a look at this. Now, why have I got them in a little container? Because I didn't want to touch them with my hands. Frogs, we must try never touch with your hands, because we quite often have caustic compounds on our hands and fingers, and it burns the very porous skin of these frogs. So I've picked up these frogs without touching them, and I won't touch them. But what I do want to show you is share these little guys with you. That is a full-grown male Bushveld rain frog. And what they're doing is they are walking around looking for a female Bushveld rain frog, which is about the size of this dish. Can you imagine? So she's about this size, the size of this dish. He will then find her. If he finds her first, he climbs up onto her back, and he basically starts to give off a type of slime that excites the female to give off a type of glue. And basically what happens is she then sticks this little male frog to her. And for most of the season, he stays glued to the back of this female Bushveld rain frog. And she walks around with him while he's stuck to her with a type of glue. Isn't that awesome? But just have a look at the faces of these. They are, for me, the single best thing about these little rain frogs are these epic faces that they have. They just look like little aliens. That is so cool. Giving us a nice standing still so that we can actually see them. So no bigger than your thumbnail. The female frog is about as big as a lady's fist. So if you make your fist, all you ladies out there, and you close your fist, the female frog is about this size. And this little Bushveld rain frog then comes up, sticks on, she glues him, and she walks off and doesn't really remember that he's even there for the rest of it. All right, so what we're going to do now is put them back exactly where I got them from. They were both actually walking around over here. You can see why I wanted to pick them up for you. You'll see how camouflaged that little frog is right there. Just have a look at the end of my finger. That's where this frog is. Very, very small. You can have a look at there. Half the size of my thumbnail, in actual fact. All right, we're going to leave them to look for their female. Carry on with our walk. Bushveld rain frog.
Yes.
Send you over to James. He's got some wild beast.
That is a very small frog. Well, that isn't, of course. Steph's little frog is very small. That is a wildebeest. And they often eat in sort of cohabitation with the zebra. These ones were not too far away from some zebra. And they too eat very short grass, which makes them able to take advantage of these sorts of conditions. Now, I'm just doing up my jacket, of course, because it's a... well, it's quite chilly out here, I must tell you. Let's go forward a little bit. The wind is now really starting to howl in an unpleasant fashion. I don't envy Stefan being out on foot in this. Now, Brian has a very nice term for wildebeest, and that is, Brian...
No.
Wildenbeest.
Wildenbeestens,
yes. Yes. I don't know why I find that funny, but I do. It's because it's Sunday morning, Brian.
It is.
And I'm very humorous on a Sunday morning, yes.
Very humorous.
Very interesting that two animals, like the zebra and the wildebeest, which live in completely similar habitats, have completely different colours, skins, and seemingly are successful as one another. I do not understand that. I don't believe that anybody really understands that. Safe to say that there is more than one way to skin a cat. In other words, there is more than one survival strategy to living in the same environmental conditions. The wildebeest, dark black color, no brain. The zebra, striped, seemingly slightly cleverer. Definitely much more aggressive. I'm being nasty about the wildebeest. I don't think they're any more stupid than any other animal. And their reputation for idiocy, I think, just comes from the slightly gormless look that they have on their faces. I don't truly believe them to be any less intelligent than any other animal. Certainly more intelligent than some people I've met. This is a very large herd of wildebeesten for this area. And soon they too will be calving in much the same way that the impala should hopefully start lambing today, because Brian predicted it today, didn't you, Brian? Yes. Sunday, the 13th of November, 2016.
Impala Lamb Day.
Impala Lamb Day. ILD. Very, very similar kind of strategy to the zebra. And they're in excellent condition. Now, we've been banging on, or I've been banging on about how terribly the buffalo have managed to get through the drought and how they failed to take advantage of the new grass. These guys have quite the opposite. None of them look vaguely thin. They all look skinny and fat and very well indeed. See, none of them have their hips showing. There's one migrating. You see that, Brian? Mm-hmm. Loving the grass, and that one's probably just about a year old. And the year old one will have horns like that, of course. And much like with the impala, they're relatively easy to age because they are seasonally born. So They're born around about this time, so if you see one that is slightly smaller than an adult around about this time, you know it's about a year old. There is no mystique to understanding the age of a wildebeest calf, Brian.
No.
But to understanding the age of a wildebeest adult, well, that is mysterious. Once they get to adult size, it's very difficult. That's probably a two-year-old. See, the horn's not quite yet fully developed, but almost there. It also seems to have some issue with its tail. It is sticking out to the behind. Now, we're nearly at the very far western corner of Arethusa, from which we will turn south and then down towards Windmill Pan. Now, the point of this, of course, is that we are still just quickly checking whether we have communications with the final control, and it is my duty to inform you that we have wonderful communications with the final control. So finally, I think our radio woes are over, and we can continue to traverse Arethusa with not any fear at all. They are now crossing the road into Simbambali. Let us continue going forward. And we will head down to the south shortly. Tingana was around here yesterday. That's kind of why we came here, other than just to check what's going on with the radios. This is a really nice wildebeest sighting. They don't normally stand for us for this length of time. Be interesting to know when they catch our scent, because the wind is coming from left to right onto them, if they become afraid. Marvellous. Having a very nice breakfast out here. They don't seem to be particularly nervous, and also, you know, again, their strength, if you look at them, they're very good condition, of course, which means their minds and bodies are sharp, and that means that they're not too worried about the lions at the moment, because they're able to run away, they're able to sort of fight the lions off, and the lions are just completely distracted by the ineptness of the buffalo and their ability not to deal with these difficult conditions. Rebecca, could you give me just a communications check to make sure that you are, in fact, still with us? There we go. She is still with us, everybody. Now, Fuzzman Sparkles, you're wondering about birth and when these chaps are going to give birth. Well, almost now. So it wouldn't surprise me to see the first wildebeesten calf at some stage soon. I'm just trying to see if I can't find a very obvious... Well, I mean, they're all fairly obviously pregnant. That one there moving towards us, a pregnant cow. And you can just see they're pregnant because they're very heavy in the belly. Excellent. Let us move along. See what else we can see, Brian. We did see one elephant bull, everybody, but he disappeared in some very thick bush, so we didn't bother to stay with him. Right here. What else does this cut line between two reserves, between two worlds, have to offer us? Brian, are you a bit chilly?
A little bit.
Brian's a bit chilly, everybody. He's only brought one jacket. He normally... Waterbuck! Yes, hello. Come on, give us a chew. Come on. Yes. No. I love the chalky little eyeliner that they have above their eyes. This waterbuck looks a little bit skittish. Maybe it has seen Tingana. I suspect the wildebeest would be a little bit more upset than they are behind us. Maybe he's just seen the wildebeest. She has just seen the wildebeest. You know how you can tell it's a female, Brian?
I do know how.
By the eyeshadow?
Yes.
Yes.
The shape of the fur.
The shape of the fur and the eyeshadow, exactly. Yes, males have slightly less eyeshadow on, and, well, the fur is... The fur is a little more scraggly. We are, of course, talking rubbish, everybody. They males have got horns. This one has no horns. Just show us that it has no horns, Brian, just above its head there. Yeah, there you see. No horns at all. Well done. Heart-shaped nose. I think it's just watching the wildebeest. Right, good, marvellous, excellent. Carry on. Here we go. There's actually quite a lot out here this time of the day. Comms check, Rebecca, please. It's amazing. Full communications. Not sure what's happening with the Ninka Puma Pride at the moment, but if they do anything of any note whatsoever, we'll hand you over to them. There, I think, everybody, is a lesser spotted eagle. Now, I suspect many of you wouldn't have seen the lesser spotted eagle, so while Brian trains his camera on it as it flies behind a bush... Oh, there it goes. Let me just put the binoculars onto it. Do you see the windows on its... What are those things that it uses to fly?
Feathers.
Feathers, wings. Wings. Well, those windows of white on its wings are often an indication that it is a lesser spotted eagle as opposed to a tawny. It wasn't a Wahlberg's. Its tail was too fat. Now, I don't know how many of you have had the lesser spotted eagle on your bird lists, but I think that was one. I'll give it to you. And they, of course, are migratory birds. And differentiated from the greater spotted eagle, I think, by a smaller size. Just got to make sure we don't drive into elephant plains here. Which I don't think we're going to. I think we turn south just over here. There are some impala, Brian. Our cup runneth deeply over. Now, many of your viewers are telling me, that's interesting, nothing about impala, you're not telling me. You're telling me about the chestnut, and that the chestnut is a throw over to the reduction of the number of toes to, of course, just, I think they've only got three inside the hoof there. That's interesting. I'm just slightly suspicious of that because it's above the wrist joint. So, it must be... If it's above the wrist joint, it must be a reduction in which bone? Maybe the carpal bone. Maybe the carpal bones? No, but those would be in the wrist. Anyway, that's very interesting. Thank you very much for that information. I will continue some research into the chestnut. Those chaps have just put their fur out now because it's a little bit cold. I thought maybe they were a bit mangy, but I don't think they are. I think they've just stood their fur up in order to reduce the chilliness of the breeze blowing over them. It's rather a special fleece, that, isn't it? Do you think you can describe an impala as having a fleece? No, probably only a sheep. It does look fleecy. And of course, these are the goats of the bush, everyone. This is like a wild goat. It is a browser and grazer. I'm not sure that it eats cardboard, though, or plastic. Roger, one of the main reasons, of course, that these animals are so successful is that they do not have a favorite food group. Roger wanted to know about their favorite food group. They eat whatever is available. As long as they have water, they can eat browse or graze with equal success. They can eat marula fruits, and they do eat marula fruits and various other things. They will sometimes eat, suck a few bones, and they maintain their health because they do not have to eat graze or browse exclusively. So whatever's available, their favorite food will be whatever's available at whatever particular time of year it might be. Now that young male, of course, is also 1 year old. Right, Stefan Winterboer has got something else I think he wishes to show you. We're going to turn south very shortly.
You know, Mother Nature is a wonderful, wonderful thing. This rather nondescript plant has the most amazing feature. This plant is called Dema by the local Shangaan tribe and is used in traditional medicine, used widely in traditional medicine. Only grows here. And this is how big the plant gets, but have a look at what grows under it. An elephant kindly excavated one of them for us. And have a look at this. This is a tuber that is growing underneath that little plant. Isn't this incredible? Massive, eh? They get to about double the size. Now, I know Dema for being used in a potion or a, what did a, I don't know, what do you call it? But a drink for pregnant women to give healthy pregnancies, but also in an effort to help women conceive. So this is used widely in the southern part of the Kruger National Park for that. But I'm told that it is used in almost all traditional medicines in this particular area, where they use it as a binding agent for various compounds, for various different root mixtures and compounds that use it as a binding mixture. Isn't that incredible? It's been eaten here. This was probably done by the elephant that excavated it, but is being chewed on pretty much non-stop. Let's have a look here. By a bunch of different rodents. That looks like a mouse. Here's some porcupine. And as this lies here in the bush, it's being utilized by almost everything. I just find that just such an incredibly awesome story. And just coming from something so small. Now you get two different kinds. One is white on the inside. The other one is red. So let's see which one this is most likely. Yeah, that reddish color that you can see there, or the reddy color there, is definitely from that plant. And very juicy, I must be honest with you. I think if we had to go inside that plant, we'd actually be able to see. Now, Dina, you've asked, do they use the tuber or the leaves for the medicinal purposes? Dina, it would almost certainly be the tuber. Although leaves out here are second to roots and root bark in terms of the medicinal properties, by far and wide, all the goodness is lying in that juice that hopefully we'll see coming out there now. There we go. You can see it running down my fingers. All the goodness lies in that juice there. And that's where most of the compounds will be stored and concentrated, would be in this root. Mm. Has a very potato-y type smell, and no noticeable, it doesn't have a bad taste at all. Ooh. Now, Winter Prison, you just asked, is this the root of a tiny plant? Absolutely, I'll actually take you back to that. So this massive root that you see over here, this tuber, is the tuber, is the root system of the plant that I'll go and show you now. This is the plant here. This tiny little plant that I'm holding in my fingers here. That massive thing that we were just with, that is the tuber or the root of this little plant, known locally as Dema, D-E-M-A. Amazing, eh? wipe off my tool. Let me show you another amazing thing here. This piece of cheesy looking bone is the skull of a buffalo. But uniquely, the skull of this buffalo has had the boss ripped off or chewn off by probably a hyena. Now, you can see over here, this is where the eyes are, one an eye. This is where the nose came out towards you there. So one eye there, one eye there. The nose would have been here towards your screen. The boss and the horn, that's the horn on the one side. And the horn on the other side would have sloped out like that. And then this would have had that mass of boss over the top that's now been chewed out and has left us the chance to see how thick the covering of bone is on the top of that buffalo skull. That is at least, you can see there, my fingers width deep. And I never actually knew that they were covered in so many chambers. That's incredible. And that's obviously what gives this particular buffalo the ability to bash heads with one another. And that's how they fight. They bump heads with one another. Protects the brain. This is the brain case over here. Amazing. And you can see inside there. Now, I am told that James has a live buffalo to show you, and he can then show you what this looks like in real life.
These buffalo are now heading into the west. We are on the Elephant Plains boundary, so those Elephant Plains buffalo, again, we've got a lot to look in there, so just be quiet about it. But it's a small breeding herd of buffalo and doing what we've been seeing the buffalo doing. And mercifully not doing what I said they weren't doing, and that is eating grass. You can see they're eating leaves from cambrium trees, full of tannins and things. So the buffalo, of course, do not have the digestive systems to really cope with excessive amount of tannin, and so they're not looking quite as healthy as the wildebeestens. Are they, Brian?
No.
No, they are not. Now, there is some sort of sighting going on in Arethusa, everybody, but I cannot figure out what it is yet. So I'm kind of, it's quite an interesting thing. So we're on the radio. I can hear the Game Drive channel sort of sometimes. And it's a little bit like as a human being, when you've got a smell, you know, you can smell something. And so you head towards it. Because you can't really accurately predict where it is, it's a bit of hit and miss. So we're trying to sort of drive closer to where the sound is coming from, and hopefully we'll figure out what sighting it is and where it is. It could easily be on Elephant Plains. But in the meantime, we're managing to find quite a lot of good plains game. We've seen wildebeestens, we've seen zebras and impalas. We did see some kudu, but they ran off. And now a breeding herd of browsing buffalo. That is many bees, Brian.
Many.
Brian, a breeding herd of browsing buffaloes.
Wonderful.
Yes. They're a very obvious cow. Now, I'm not sure what kind of a skull Steph showed you. I know it was a buffalo. I'm not sure if it was male or female. With the female buffalo skull, not nearly as thick around the front as the males, and that's because the females, like, well, a bit like human beings, they tend to fight less. They don't butt heads. They sort out their differences with conversation, Brian. Hello, Junkie. You want to know how thick a human skull is? Well, I haven't ever dissected a human skull, but, Junkie, as far as I'm aware, a human skull is about 3 millimeters thick, 3 to 5 millimeters thick, and it'll vary throughout its, you know, depending on which part of the skull you're on. But interestingly, the front of the skull and the back of the skull, I suppose, will thicken in males, or male human beings, that is, men, and also in those who bash their heads quite a lot. So you'll find a boxer or a martial artist or a rugby player or a gridiron footballer will, and probably sort of an ice hockey player, will certainly get a thickening of the skull because of repeated bashing. And that happens also to buffalo, it happens to giraffe as well. So those who completely are often bashing their heads will get a thickened skull. I'm not much of a head basher myself, so I imagine mine not to be too thick. I used to get horribly concussed playing the great game of rugby football. No, Rebecca, not a headbanger, that is something else. A headbanger gets sore neck muscles and migraineous headaches. That was me looking disparaging everybody at Rebecca. Rebecca says that's how I look at her every day. Let's head across to Taylor and find out what the nincompoopers are doing at the moment.
Now we're trying to catch up with the Nkuhuma pride again, but they're being very sneaky this morning, as they're moving through a drainage system and it's proving quite difficult to try and keep up with them. We try to loop around and then they change direction again, but Rexon is on them. But now we just need to try and find a way back in. And of course, it is very, very, very windy out here. I can't even hear myself. We're just gonna try and find our way back in. Let me just see if Rexon's perhaps looking for me. Right. Go along this bumpy section. So I'm just checking vehicle tracks just to see exactly where Rexon has gone in again. And that's the problem when these lions move through these drainage systems. It's almost impossible to keep up with them because they join each other at all sorts of angles. Sometimes the banks are too steep to go through, so you can't follow them the same route. You've got to try and make your own route around, which is tough. But luckily, we've got a short wheel-based vehicle, so it makes it a little bit easier for us. I think Rexon will let us know when he can hear us.
Station, yeah, we're fine, this is Zala. Yeah, only eastern side of the drainage line, west of...
Sorry, I can't hear anything, Rebecca. Sorry, can you go again, Rebecca? It's so windy that I cannot hear anything that is being sent.
Follow that tracks.
Ah, there we go. Grant, you want to know how old the cubs are? I'll answer that in a moment. Sure. Okay. I'm just trying to figure out where the lions are. Okay, let's check if there's fresh vehicle tracks. Yeah, freshish. Now, Grant, sorry, from New Zealand, you'd like to know how old the lion cubs are. Well, they're aging quite quickly, and I find that this is something that we as guides have a bad habit of doing, is we forget that they age and we keep calling them the same sort of age for about a year. But the oldest cubs are about 6 months old now, and well, the next set is 5 months, and the set prior to that is only 4 months. It seems they only had a month apart, which is quite nice, but you can clearly see the difference now between the 6 month old cubs. They're much larger than the rest of the pride. I think we're getting warmer, and at least it's not so windy out here either. My goodness, it was howling when we were out in the open. We're just gonna follow this road down, and hopefully we're going to see Rexon's vehicle. All right, let's have a look here. Oh, there we go. I can see Rexon's vehicle now. Whether we're going to be able to fit all the vehicles here, I'm not sure. We'll have to go and investigate. Oh, thank goodness. It seems as though they're sitting down now. Whew. That would have been a tough one to keep following them again. Sneak through here. All right, let's... We'll go over that. We'll find, try and find a little gap, yeah? Yes, okay, I'm going to go around all the way to the other side because I think we'll have a look at the cubs. Oh, they're sleeping, look. There they are. All hiding away from the terrible weather that we're experiencing today. Oh, isn't that precious? All the little cubs huddled up together to try and keep nice and warm. And that's something we haven't really been seeing over the last couple of weeks because it's been so hot. It's quite nice to see them when they huddle up like that. Now, I must tell you, this morning I only counted 7 cubs. I don't know where the 8th one is, and the last time I saw the Nkuhumas, all 8 cubs were around. But we're also missing 2 lionesses, so maybe one of the cubs could be with one of the other lionesses, I'm uncertain. But we won't know until the entire pride is back together again. But remember, I'm not saying that anything has happened because I have absolutely no idea, I'm only really just speculating, is that lion cubs only really have about a 60% chance of making it towards adulthood. So the fact that we've seen 8 of them get so far in life already has been quite spectacular. We'll just have to see what happens. Let me just count again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now I can still only see 7 cubs. There's another one, you can probably only count 6, but there's another cub that's being groomed by a lioness off to the far left, but it's very difficult to see because they're behind some trees. But we'll keep positive though, and hopefully we will find the rest, the one missing little cub, when the whole pride reunites again. But to me, that is just absolutely precious. Now, we were chatting about how Brent and Jamie said that they saw the lions trying to take down a hippo quite late last night in front of where they live. They said they obviously weren't successful though. And Anna Marie, you were wondering if they made a kill. So I think other than that attempt where they did try to take down that hippo, I don't think they were successful at all. And what we will do is once we've done over here, we'll probably go back around to where we saw, where we've been seeing them. And we had that buffalo carcass on Wahlberg's junction with Twin Dams. And maybe we'll go and have a look around there. Now, Amber, you're also wondering how many lions it would take to take down a hippo. That would depend on the size of the hippo. If it's that bull that we've been seeing in the pan where the dam cam is, well, then it's quite a young boy, but strong and not small. I reckon a few more lions. I reckon if they had about 10 lions, they'd probably be able to bring it down. That would be a fair amount of size because that hippo is so strong. It can't necessarily run away quickly like maybe something like a kudu or a buffalo could because there's so much surface area on a hippo, you might find that more than one lion would jump on the back and that would, of course, slow it down. But to try and get that that hippopotamus down onto the ground and to try and suffocate it is a completely different story. So it's a very, very difficult meal. And I believe my parents are actually just in the Kruger National Park and they said they just missed a male lion taking down a baby hippo. Now, Charles, you were also thinking, and I love these questions about the hippos, you were saying would they be able to take down a hippo in the water? Once again, it depends on their size, and I suppose it's also got to do with their health condition. If it was a hippo that was weakened severely by the drought conditions, it would probably be much easier to take down. Oh, look how sweet this is. My favorite little girl getting in there to try and keep nice and warm. Now, I have seen it before where lions will go in the water to go and sort of fish their prey out, so whether it's a kudu or something inside, but up in this area it doesn't seem to be as common. You know, the lions aren't as well adapted to the water like the lions in the Delta and Botswana are. Obviously they have to live with the conditions of crossing channels every single day of their life, so they become quite used to it. These lions, well, I've seen it where they'd prefer to walk the scenic way around than cross a big puddle of water. But that's just the lions in this particular area. But they may, if they were desperate and they were hungry, and there was a hippo in the shallows that was quite weak, or maybe injured, they'd definitely go for it and try and drag it out. But at the moment, we haven't really seen the Ngurhumas desperately trying to eat anything, seen as though there's such an abundance of prey around that have been weakened. But that's going to change. Just wait until we have proper rain and all the grass has come through quite nicely. So I reckon around February, these lions are going to have a challenge ahead of them. But it's only fair. It's only fair that the herbivores and the prey species also have a chance to come back again. And that's what's so wonderful about nature, is that everything has its day and has its chance to make a comeback. And this is a really great spot that they've got here. They're hiding in and amongst these smaller shrubs, which is providing lots of shelter from the wind. It's quite unpleasant. And if it gets any worse, then they can just dip down into the drainage line, well, and then they'll be out of the wind completely. Now, I do feel terribly sorry for Steph today as he tries to move around and with all this wind. It must be a little bit daunting not being able to hear what's around you. And I think we're going to leave these lions, and I'm going to go and have a look and see if I can find the rest of the pride. But as you know, I need to get out of this thicket now. So let's go back across to Steph and see how he's facing the wind this morning.
It is a little bit daunting around here because of the wind, but what the wind has brought is now total cloud cover. So this morning, when we started the show, we could just see the blue sky with these clouds scudding over. They're now almost totally covered the sky. In actual fact, it's just getting thicker as we speak. It's incredible. And of course, it's getting more and more gloomy and more ominous, which is the best. To be quite honest, this is what the wet season brings here. It brings these clouds and it brings this dynamic weather that we enjoy so much. But you can see this thick bush that we've got in front of us here. This is the type of bush normally we just walk through, but on a day like today I absolutely will not walk through bush like this, and it's because we can't hear what's going on in there. There's a lot of movement, the trees are making a lot of movement, and so animals' movements are concealed behind that movement. And then you've also got the added added problem of having too much wind, and that sort of masks any noises, growls, their horns hitting some branches, snapping trees. And so what you want to do is you want to be keeping to areas like we've got over my shoulder here, which are wide open and allow you the chance to see straight through it. So we're avoiding thick bush areas today, and basically we're just walking on the edge of these thickets trying to find you some interesting things to show you. And so far so good. Well, here we go. Here's something interesting to show you. This tree that you see here, I'll go and stand next to it in a second, is a beautiful example of a milkwood tree. Now, milkwoods are one of James Hendry's favorite trees, and they are one of my favorites as well, because they get this beautiful berry that comes out at Christmas time. If you want to see, bless you, Vim. Instead of, in case any of you heard what that was VM sneezing, sounding like a buffalo. This is beautiful foliage. Isn't it very, the wood of this tree can't be used for too much, but it is this beautiful green foliage that has this yellow midrib, and that's how you can identify it, with that yellow midrib down the leaf, and then that teardrop shaped leaf. It gets these bunches of berries that you can come and pick off around Christmas time and eat. Very tasty, sweet berries. Oh, beautiful tree. All right, let's carry on. While we look for more creepy crawlies, I think Mr. Hendry has got a creepy crawly to show you as well. We'll catch up in a little bit.
Right, everybody, we are on Arethusa, as I said, and there is a dung beetle there. And what I want to do is get out, sorry, I'm just in your way there, get out and show you how brilliant it is at orientating itself. Now, don't worry about it, because they're so clever that it will figure out where it's going. So we pick it up like this. And this, of course, is dung, obviously. And the beetle is going to push the dung in exactly the right direction. See now, it stands on top of the dung and figures out which way it should be facing. So if I turn it like that, now this one's not so good. Normally what they do is stand on top of the dung pile. There we go, figures out where it's going, and then it starts to move. It's really quite clever. I'm slightly worried that that was baboon dung. But I subtly smelt my hand, and we seem to be okay. I think it's not baboon dung. Anyway, there it goes. It will go and find probably a mate. In fact, I suspect this is probably the female who's made that ball, and she's going to go and bury it somewhere and put her egg in it, or she would have laid her egg already. There you can see it turning around every so often on top of the ball, orientating. There we go. Now, she's either prepared a hole somewhere or she will still dig one, but she knows where she's going. It's just amazing. It must be the most frustrating process, pushing a ball like that. It falls, she falls down, it falls down. Can you still see it, Brian? There, she's found the hole. Can you still see it? Can you see it now? In the way. How's that? So she's found her hole, everybody, and she's now burying it. So she's digging from underneath. We haven't found any impala lambs just yet. I can just hear some impala calling off to the right-hand side. Isn't that cool? So that dung ball is going to go under the ground there. Can you see the soil moving there? That is so cool. Now, I can't answer any questions if you do have them, I'm afraid. But while we just watch this sort of unfold, to tell you that this is now definitely a female because she's burying the ball. The males don't bury the balls. They make the balls and then attract letties with them. They take them off and they mate and eat a good meal of dung. And then she'll go off back to the dung pile, make a ball like that, lay the egg in the middle, and then roll it off to a spot like this where it is buried. That is fantastic. It's disappearing ever so slowly. While the wind blows and the Diedrich's cuckoo goes. Can you see it still?
Yep.
It's almost gone. Now she's turning it over inside, I think probably to give it a covering of soil. Now she's prepared this hole. This is not a new hole, she's made it there. It's gone now. I have never seen this before. In all my years of watching dung beetles, I've never seen them actually bury a ball like this. Can you still see it, Brian, or is it gone?
Slightly see it.
Just see it. How fantastic. She's using her spade-like front part of her head. It was elephant dung, thankfully. I can actually see the dung pile where they're gathering it. Marvellous. Well, let's leave that there. The dung pile's just up ahead there on the road, over here. There we go. Very new dung ball being made here. And of course, Brian, you can see next to my lovely green laces, can't you?
Yes.
Yes. Marvellous. Let's press on. We're right next to Arethusa Camp at the moment. Brian and I are probably going to pull in there for some breakfast, I think, because it's a bit cold out here. Yeah, let me plug myself back in. There we go. And on we trundle. I'm trying to avoid these beetles, which are not very good at judging traffic. Stacy, you're wondering why I was nervous about it being baboon dung. It would be bad, Stacy, because baboon dung, all I got is bleh. Chelsea, you're wondering about, Chelsea, you're wondering why it would be bad if it was baboon dung. Chelsea, it would be bad if it was baboon dung because baboon dung stinks. It's disgusting smelling. The baboon is an omnivore. It's not shy of a bit of carrion and meat. And, it just smells foul. But elephant dung does not. Rebecca, I think you may have spoken there, but it went deep, deep. That's interesting that it's been so good up until now. All right, we got which I think means Link Taylor something. Let's go and find out what she's got.
We've come across a very gloomy scene this morning that consists of a dead knobthorn tree with a number of vultures. Now, I wonder where they're off to. You can see they're all leaving us now. There were quite a few of them on the tree, but we're just down to four as they slowly started to disappear. Perhaps there is another carcass around that they're off to go and feed on. I don't think that they're going to be doing too much flying today in the sense of reaching the high altitudes that they're normally able to get to. With this cloud cover and wind and the size of these birds, I think it's going to be quite tricky for them. So perhaps they're just going to hang around all the carcasses that are around Vuyatela Dam. Now, I've also got some other good news for you. We heard a male lion roaring just as we were leaving those lions. Now, it was difficult because it was so windy, and we know that the wind muffles sound quite a bit, but it sounded like it was coming back in this direction. So let's go back and check where that old carcass was, where James was trying to get into yesterday afternoon, and have a look around there. So we're just passing the dam now. We're gonna go across the dam wall. Oh, vultures. And I also need to hold on to my hat. I apologize if you hear some strange noises. See. Now, when he did roar, I had a look at the lionesses, but they didn't seem to show any interest in him at all. They were quite keen to just have a snooze. Okay, let's have a look-see. Just check here very carefully. Oh, there's some impalas coming down though. Let's say hello to them. Hello, impala. Just a small herd, not a particularly big group like we have been seeing. And no babies just yet. And I feel sorry for that young man who's in front, because unfortunately, when the new lambs come around, those little ones are going to be kicked out and they're going to have to go off and join, well, find a bachelor group. You're very brave, taking the lead. See how she's now stopped as she's reaching the top of that incline. Have a look around. And that's something very similar that we do when we are walking and we're out on foot, is when you're down in a drainage system and you're coming out of it, you move up very slowly, and just before you get to the top, you stop and you listen, just to make sure that there's nothing up and above you. And then, well, then you carry on. Lucky for them, though, it's nice and open, and we know how fantastic the eyesight of the impala is. So they're really the lucky ones today. They don't have to just rely on their sense of smell and their hearing, because we know that, for instance, animals like elephants, animals like buffalo, even a kudu is going to be slightly disadvantaged with all this wind today. But not the impala and the zebra. They'll still be jumpy, but they rely on their eyesight a lot more. But let's continue further. Let's see. We're not far from where their old carcass site is. Sorry, I'm just moving my head. Sometimes I pull it too far down when we're driving to prevent it from blowing off of my head. And then sometimes it's so low that you can't even see my eyes. But we're not going very fast here. We're going quite slowly, in fact. That doesn't sound good. Have I got a flat tire?
No.
What was that? Maybe I drove over a stone. Now, I keep making David check all my tires because we've been doing some serious off-roading today. Now, Kathy from Tennessee, you're wondering if the behavior of the pregnant impala will change just before they give birth, and you're quite correct in that. What will happen? There is a lion footprint. Can you see the lion footprint down there, David?
Yeah.
Is it? No, that's fine. Let me reposition. I just wanted to double check that it was indeed a lion footprint and not a hyena footprint. Let's have a look and see who it is. Who's been walking here? Those look big. Those look very big. Sorry, Kathy, I'll get to your question. You can see it's quite difficult. Let me jump out quickly. Oh, I've got to change around. I'm going to double check and see who it was. And I must say I'm very stiff from the running club yesterday. Rebecca, I don't know how you're feeling. Where is that footprint? So I'm going to go to this one because I think this one's a little bit clearer, if that's okay, David. Now, it's big. My hand is just slightly longer than it, but it's not wider than it. So straight away, I'm able to see that it is as wide as it is long. That means it's a male lion track. Now, I don't remember seeing these footprints when we came through here initially, and they look like they're actually on top of some of our tire tracks. And I wonder if this wasn't this male that was calling, and maybe he's come down already, crossed the drainage system. This is quite interesting. See, there's also been a lot of wind, so there is some sand that's blown over it, but that could have just been from 5 minutes of wind. You get plugged in quickly, okay? Let's just very quickly check the last spot. Maybe we get lucky. So sorry, Kathy, let me get back to your question. You're very right in saying or thinking that their behavior does change. So what happens is that when just before they give birth, they're gonna go off and they're gonna find a secluded spot. They actually leave the herd and then they'll give birth. And they'll wait a couple of days in the thicker vegetation to try and conceal that young lamb until it's really able to run around on its legs quite nicely and is fit enough to keep up with the rest of the herd. But it normally doesn't last too long. It's normally just a couple of days. Now, I think they were going in here. Let me just have a look. I can't remember now. But that's very interesting about those male lion tracks. I didn't see them earlier. I'm going to poke my nose in here because I also saw some vultures sitting in the thicket. I'm having a little scan. Now, it doesn't seem like they're in here. I'm going to check because there were two entrances, so that's okay. But the other one, we've got to do a bit more of a bundu bash, of course, which is the local word for off-roading. So I think we're going to have to go back across to Steph, and hopefully while you do that, I'll be able to find this mysterious male lion.
Now, wandering around over here in the bush, trying not to bump into buffalo and not bump into the lion that Taylor is tracking, is of course a difficult thing on a windy day like today, but it does allow us to explore what is happening over here. And one of these new things that I have in my backpack to share with you is a stethoscope. And this is something that you can very easily do from your own homes. This is obviously just a normal stethoscope. You can buy them over the counter in most chemists or pharmacies all over the place. And what you do with this is you walk up to a tree that looks like it's got some activity. Oh, look here. Here is a prime example of a pill millipede. And you can see why they call it a pill millipede. When you disturb them, they turn into these little round pellets. That is a millipede. Much the same as the other millipedes that we're finding all over the place at the moment. Isn't that awesome? Coming out from underneath this rotting stump. Right, so now back to what you do with these things is you put them in your ears and you listen to the inside of these trees. And if there's significant insect activity, you can hear it. In this particular case, what you'd be listening to is borer beetles making a chewing noise. You'd have to move it around to find one of their tunnels. But I tell you, once you've found one, they're unmistakable for what you can hear. I can't hear anything at the moment. Vacant stare that I have. And I better put my earpiece back in my ear in case Rebecca is busy telling me something of vital importance. But basically, you can do this from your home. Walk up to any tree. Trees with a smooth bark or a thin bark are the best. Dead trees obviously give you the most action from a what you can hear point of view. But just try that at a point. Take a stethoscope, listen to the trees in your garden. You'd be surprised at what noises come out of these giant old pieces of wood. Awesome. It gives us some time to... JT, you want to know what else I carry in my backpacks on my walk? Well, JT, I've got a water bottle. I have a stethoscope. I have a tarpaulin for when it rains. I have some paracord for the tarpaulin. And then I have my bag of tricks. Inside, I have a wood saw, which helps us with setting up little satellite camps and gives me sticks to basically walk around on. I have a selection of fire steels to make fire with. This is a new one at the moment that I have that I'm playing with, made with a slightly different steel. So this one make some fire with it. So I have a selection of these fire steels in here. I then have let's unpack this for you and see what else I have inside of here. I change it from time to time, to be honest. I have some hand wash and some other fire making thingies, and then a whole bag of headache tablets, matches, some sunscreen, plasters, yeah, a variety of some rehydrate in case we get dehydrated out here. So basically that's what I carry in my backpack there, a selection of different goodies and tricks to keep us entertained. We do also have a backpack on Herbert, and he has the more functional of all the things. He carries the first aid kit. He also carries some more water and a bunch of spare camera paraphernalia in case we get a breakdown out here that we need to service. So some more batteries and some gaffer tape and some bunch of goodies. So that's that. Backpack 101, really. All right. On that note, I'm going to send you over to James. He's got an update for you.
We have come to the southern end of Arethusa now, everybody. I'm afraid we have found nothing further since we last saw you with the dung beetles. And in fact, what we did see was that the Arethusa Dam, I thought perhaps had filled up a little, is bone dry, and there are two carcasses of buffalo that died there, sort of stuck in the mud, and it's all a rather sort of droughtish type scene. And of course, we know the drought has broken. We've had pretty good rain here, but it will take an immense, immense deluge to fill up that very large dam. And in case you've never seen the dam before, there is a big one in front of the Arethusa Lodge, which is where we left you last. And, well, it will fill up, hopefully, with some water sometime soon. Now, we were describing, of course, the different properties that we drive on. We've just come off Arethusa now, and we're going to turn to the north, that is to the left. There we are. And this is now the sort of, what is it? It's called the break, I suppose, between us and a reserve called Hoffmann's to the right-hand side. We don't go into Hoffmann's, so we can only look to the left-hand side. Brian, are you looking to the left-hand side?
Yeah. Also looking to the right.
Oh, but Brian, you're such a rebel. I'm obviously being facetious. We can look any side of the road we like, but we cannot go to the right-hand side. I'm going to drive a little bit faster. Nice, smooth road. We want to get back towards Juma. Lots of nice general game we saw in Arethusa, but nothing in the way of high-profile animals such as leopards, lions. We did see buffalo. They are high-profile. And eddies. Ooh. Now, Mike, you want to know what causes corrugations on the road, and I'm not entirely sure I know, but I think what it is a resonance, and what happens is the shock absorbers on a car set up a resonance, and they bump like that, obviously. Once you go over one bump, so say you hit one little stone or something, there will be a certain amount of resonance as the shock absorber stops bouncing, and that tends to leave a dent on the road. The next car that comes along then does the same thing, so that if obvious corrugations on the road. As far as I understand, that's how corrugations are made on the road. Brian, are you any better equipped to answer that question?
No, that's exactly what I thought.
Brian thought the same thing, that true.
Obviously.
I was rather hoping the... Ooh, my signal's not very good. Let's head straight to Taylor.
Now, we've done numerous checks to see if we can find these lions, but sadly, no luck. So I think that everybody's really just settled down, trying to hide away from this miserable weather. And I did get a report on the radio. Hang on. Oh, I see a bird on the left. Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Can you see it in the tree there? It looks like a cuckoo. It is a cuckoo. It looks like a female, maybe a female Deirdre's cuckoo. Let's get the book out. I think this is going to require some inspection. You can see it's not particularly brightly colored. No greens on it. It's definitely not a Levalence or a Jacobin cuckoo, so it's one of the others. So let's have a look. See, it could even be maybe even a female African cuckoo. Let me just check. I think, no, I'm going to change my mind. Let me just have a quick look there. That's beautiful. Can you see what color its feet are, David? They look pink to you, reddish, don't they? Yes. I don't know if you can see that, but it's got reddish colored feet. Now that's a good thing to look at. So I'm just double checking in my book as we page through here. Oh, what are you? The only thing that I can see, it is a common cuckoo, a female common cuckoo, by the looks of it, or those yellow legs. Have a look here, David. We're going to maybe take a couple of those screenshots if you were able to. Now, I want to show you this one up top here. You see that? Don't you think that that looked exactly like what we were looking at? Yeah. Do you think so, David?
Yeah.
Very brown. It was actually quite difficult to tell the color of the legs, I'm afraid. They look pinkish, but it also just because the light is quite terrible today. But now I'll scroll through with you. That's the closest I can see, and I don't think I've ever seen a common cuckoo before. Not that I can ever really recall. So this could be a new bird for me. But David, let's have a look. Let's go through this book together. Maybe you can help us and get your and give us your opinions too. So we go down. We go down to the African cuckoo, which is the next one. Yeah. And it seems as though the male and the female actually look very similar. There's no sexual dimorphism here. The only thing they give is a juvenile. So if we go to the left, you can see just down a bit. You can see very barred, but not brown. Black and white. You see that? And then if we go to the red-chested cuckoo, which is the one just below that, you can see the adult. And again, no sexual dimorphism between the male and female. But they've got a juvenile, which is completely black, which is just to the right. You can see that? That's definitely not what we saw. Now, the Madagascar and the lesser cuckoo are very rare, so we'll turn the page. We get to another variety. We get the black cuckoo. It's definitely not a black cuckoo, so I've got a fly bothering me. It's definitely not the Levalence. It's definitely, you can see that, nothing like that. Definitely not the Jacobin. So if we go down, let's just double check the Jacobin to the left. There it is. Doesn't look anything like that. Right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn again where we get to the next set of cuckoos. Now, if we look at the top cuckoos, we get the bar long-tailed cuckoo. That is exceptionally rare to see in this area, so I have my doubts that it's that one. I don't think it was. And the beak also looks a little bit different. It looks a bit too curved. Can you see that there? I don't remember seeing that. But I'll have to have a look at some of your screenshots if you send them in by hashtagging Safari Live. And then, of course, you have a look, maybe a classes cuckoo. Let's have a look here. Now, it's quite difficult. Can you see? You see that it could be when they're in flight? No, but we saw it sitting perched, so I don't think it is. There's the female, if we go to the left. Female doesn't have very much brown on her. And then in case you were unsure, that you've even got a juvenile, which is slightly more brown in color, but still got prominent green on it. So that is quite interesting. I think I'm going to be safe, and I will double check, and I will chat about it again this afternoon. I'm going to go with a female common cuckoo. That to me is the closest. And if it was indeed, and I will discuss it, we'll have a look with Steph and James a bit later, so please send some screenshots through, that will be a new bird for me. And I'll have to tally up how many birds I've seen. Wonderful. Well, I hope it was indeed a female common cuckoo, and I hope maybe it's a new bird for all of you, but we'll have a chat and we'll get to the bottom of this mysterious cuckoo. But let's go across to James, who has got some vultures.
We do not have any cuckoos, everybody. We've got ominous birds of the scavenging variety. Four white-backed vultures, one of which has an itchy face. You see that, Brian?
I did.
Don't you sometimes wish that you could lift your back legs to your chin and give it a bit of a scratch?
Yeah.
It'd be quite nice, you know, while you were reading a book. You wouldn't have to let go of the book. Or perhaps if you were drinking some coffee or carrying something, especially. You know, when your nose gets itchy and you're carrying something, it would be very nice to be able to sort of, as Rebecca says, driving. Except, Rebecca, if you were driving, you kind of need your feet to drive, unless you drive in a very different fashion from the way I drive. Automatic car, she says. Yes, of course. I do apologize.
You still need your feet.
You still need 1 foot, yes. So you could scratch it behind your ear with your left foot. This is the most ridiculous discussion I've ever had on a game drive. I do apologize. Anyway, these vultures are facing to the southeast. That means that they can, if they would like to, just open their wings and kind of float up off that tree. They need the wind to take off because they are heavy. Don't they look rather miserable, everyone? I think they look a bit sad out there in the wind and the bluster. Right, four of them there, another whole lot in front, and the stink of rotting meat in the area. So we're just going to have a quick look around. I suspect whatever died here has been discovered some time ago, simply given that it does smell quite severe. But I haven't seen anything back here. I'm wondering if it isn't a dead beefalo that has shaken off this mortal coil. Some more further down there. We're still on Arethusa. We came back onto Arethusa, everybody. This is actually really quite nice. They don't often let us get this close. I'm going to be quiet. And just let them relax around us. Isn't that cool? Marvellous. This really is quite special. One of them just yawned. I saw it going. Excuse me. Aren't they funny looking birds? Funny looking little birds, big birds. They have been eating. You can see there's definitely a bit of muck on that one's head. Definitely had their heads inside the carcass of some dead antelope or buffalo. I wonder. I think we will definitely have to do a little bit of a turnaround here and just see if we can't spot whatever it is that they've been eating. Hello, Sutton. I'm not sure I've heard from you before. You're interested in why it is that a vulture would choose to put its head into the backside of a carcass. Well, Sutton, the reason a vulture does that is that's just the easiest way in. Now, these ones have got quite heavy beaks, and they, together with the lappet-faced vultures, are capable of sort of getting into carcasses. But the easiest way into the carcass, of course, is via the, not to put too fine a point on it, originally placed orifices. So the bottom, of course, is an access into the innards, and that's why they start there. They will often begin with the eyes, and they'll try through the nose as well, sometimes the ears, but the bottom, of course, gets them into, the belly, and, of course, all the meat around the hindquarters. But it's not only vultures that will do that. I mean, it's many animals that will go in through that part of the body. It's just easier. This is a really lovely vulture sighting. You can see it covered in gore. Now, this is a very good question from Dustin, and I keep forgetting to kind of give an indication. Dustin, you say, how tall are they? It is difficult to tell from the screen, and I'm just going to check exactly, but while I check, I'm going to guess for you that they are about 60 centimetres, so about, I'm going to say about 2 feet tall, maybe a little bit bigger, maybe 75 centimetres, which is, that's 2.5 feet. Vulture search. There we go. White-backed vulture. Tap, tap. Oh, no, they're even bigger than that. They're almost 3 feet tall. 95 centimeters is a big one. So that's pretty big, 3 feet. You know why they don't look quite so tall to me? Is that they pull their heads in. So at the head at full stretch, they're probably about 3 feet tall. But you can see they've tucked them in an ominous fashion. Oh, ominous vulture. Right, I think we're going to drive down the road and see if we can't just pick up whatever it is they've been scoffing. I'm going to go backwards because there's a road behind us. And on that road, I suspect we might have some luck. Right. While we do that, we'll... might be lucky. Steph's got something. I didn't quite copy what it was, but I've no doubt it'll be fascinating.
All right, we've just got the most amazing thing. Have a look at the end of the stick I'm going to be pointing at you now and see if you can see what is there. Oh, no. Hang on, wait. Let's do this. Here we go, Vian. So, right here, let me see if I can put the stick there again. Oh, it's this piece of jumping sand. There we go. He's now in a darker patch, and that lets us see him a little bit. That's a grasshopper, everybody. That is now in a dark piece of sand, but I promise you, no, jumped again. There he is here, Vian, at the end of the grass here. At the end of the stick is a grasshopper that lives on the sand. So difficult to see, even with the stick there, right underneath the stick. You see him yet? No? Yes? I don't think we can.
In the middle of the screen.
In the middle of the screen is a grasshopper. I know it doesn't look like much, but let me see if I can catch him so I can show him to you. Oops, here we go. No. All right, so now I've got to try and get this thing out here. There we go, got him. I've actually got two grasshoppers to show you. This is the first one I want to show you. This one that lives on the stand. These stone grasshoppers. Have a look at the camouflage on this little guy. That is a grasshopper. Exactly the same color as the sand that we're walking on. Look there. Amazing, hey? Eyes even look like the pieces of rock that we're with. He'll probably jump as soon as I put him down. Here we go. The second grasshopper that we've got here is this one. Very different to the one that lives on the sand. This grasshopper lives purely on grass and looks exactly like a leaf blade. Look at that. Isn't that amazing? Yes, that is incredible. I know, Anna Marie, you've just put the comment through. It's such amazing camouflage, isn't it just? And it's done purely to help hide these grasshoppers from would-be predators and help camouflage them when they're sleeping at night. Just those two things. And it's just led to this unbelievable array of different colors. Here's this grass, green grasshopper, this grass-like grasshopper, at my finger, looking, hiding literally behind one stalk of grass on an otherwise sandy patch. And then around us are those stone locusts, that little very sandy colored locust. And they live on these open patches of sand. And even now, there's one that's just jumped here. You can almost find them everywhere. There we go. I'll try and herd him towards you. Here he's coming. There he is. Right at the end of my finger. You see him, Vim? Here underneath the stick. Got him. Mm-hmm. Amazing, hey? I mean, you wouldn't be able to see that thing unless you came down. The only reason why we stopped here was the fact that we're finding this fur all over the place. Something killed a scrub hare here last night. That is the fur of a scrub hare. And the only reason why we stopped to have a look at this place and found these two fantastic grasshoppers was the fact that something has peeled the scrub hair and eaten it and just left us with little tufts of fur. Amazing. What an epic place. And just have a look at how plain and simple this little patch is. There's nothing much going on here at all. Very cool. Such an awesome walk this morning. I don't know, we slowed down because of the wind. We're not walking as fast or as far as what we normally do. And it's giving us this ability to sort of look in detail at everything that's around us. And it's just uncovering the most epic stuff. Like, here's another grasshopper that obviously hides on sticks at the point of my finger. So very different to the one that hides on grass and the one that hides on the sand. Oh, he's just disappeared again. It's actually amazing at how vigilant they are. Nothing underneath here today. Put the stick back and let's carry on, basically. Oh, I'm losing earpieces. Alrighty, let's carry on. Wow. We don't talk much about these guaris. This is the magic guari. I actually thought that this was the Natal guari, which is a little bit rarer here. This is the magic guari, and not the one that I was wanting to tell you about. Nevertheless, it's still quite an interesting bush. Also, on our berry theme of today, this gives a very awesome berry, a purple berry that we can eat around Christmas time as well. So, let Christmas come. All the food in the bush. Anyway, we're going to send you over to Taylor. He's got something to show you.
Now, did quite a bit of research in the last couple of minutes. I was so intrigued by the bird that we saw, and with my research I found out that it is indeed a common cuckoo, but it was an interesting morph. It's called the hepatic morph, which means liver colored, and I thought that described that bird very, very well. So now I'm not sure, it could either be a female or it could be a male, because there wasn't really too much difference other than the obvious color. But I was having a look on my bird app and they said there's actually been a couple of reports of this hepatic sort of coloration in the Sabi Sand as well as the Greater Kruger area. So isn't that amazing? That's a new bird for me, and to see that color morph as well was fantastic. So I hope some of you did get a screenshot of that common cuckoo, because I think it's quite special. Like I said, I've never come across it before. Hepatic. Oh, maybe, sorry, Rebecca's saying it's spelled, said hepatic. My app has obviously made a spelling mistake because there was no H in that word. But anyway, that's okay. And I just found that amazing. And then something else about the cuckoo, seeing as though we're on the topic of the cuckoo, is that that cuckoo, unlike the others that come and visit us, they don't breed here. So they're just non-breeding summer visitors. So they really just come to say hello and enjoy all the wonderful insects and caterpillars that they love to eat. Of course, that's really what they do. They're Palearctic migrants. So they've got to travel far and wide in order to come and visit us. They tend to breed in Siberia and China and Japan. So really quite a distance away. Now, I heard on the radio, and I started mentioning this to you earlier, that I think I'm going to head and pop my nose into Cheetah Plains. And the reason for this is that there were some reports of the Styx lioness with her new cubs somewhere in a drainage system on the Cheetah Plains driveway. Now, this was from earlier this morning and I think from yesterday as well. So I don't know if they're still going to be there, but I think it's worth a little bit of a gamble. So we're going to slowly start making our way down towards that area, but we've still got quite a distance to go. Oh, I can see there's another vehicle coming up behind us, so I'll have to pull off for them in just a moment. Let's see what else we can find though as we go along here. It's a bit tricky today with the wind. Everything hiding away from us. I don't blame them. I suppose it's okay. Oh, but I've seen an impala. My goodness. We've got a race car driver behind us. So let me quickly pull off the road when I find a little suitable spot. We'll have a quick, let's go off over here. We'll just go gently. We'll have a look at the impala. Hello, how are you? So I'm just need to have a very quick chat with this lovely vehicle that's pulled up next to us. So I think I'm going to say goodbye to you for just a moment. No, I didn't. Amazing. Okay, I'll chat then. Thank you so much. Right, that's fantastic news. Okay. Sorry about that. Now I need to chat onto the radio.
Okay, come in. Well, they say she crossed now, so she didn't be far away.
I'm gonna get back to you. I'll tell you what I'm excited about.
Yeah, I got a visual of her. She's still moving north in the block.
Seems like Karula's come across. We're gonna change our minds,
yeah,
obviously.
Zoe's junction there.
Just need to obviously try and get a word in. Which mobile's on lock with Karula?
Visual from Garamain, so yeah, she's moving north. Where are you?
I'm on Garamain, just passing Shubham Junction.
Okay, I think comes Shubham from Garamain, I'm sure you
will. Copy, thank you. That is Shubham, huh? Fantastic. Okay, so, sorry about that, but you're going to be so... Sorry, Shubham is the next one. So now what we've got is Karula has just crossed into Vuyatela, and we're not far away, so we're going to make our way straight towards there quickly and find out. So I'm so glad that the guide behind us was driving like a racer, and because, well, if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have known the news. I didn't hear on the radio. Now, if you're wondering who or what Karula is, that is the Queen of Juma, the ultimate leopardess. So that's who we're going to look for now. But we just need to jump onto the road, the right road. But I need to put my GPS on exactly.
Jamie, you're gonna make it. She's heading east now. Barbie cross Barbara.
No, I'm trying to get the right radio. Copy, Andrew, it's Taylor here. So I'll be there in the next couple of minutes. I'm just approaching Shubham. Sorry, I was at Savage's track. Whee! Let's go! Fantastic. Now, we need to very quickly go over to Steph, because if we don't link across to him, the animal that he's got may get away.
We are live with a giant land snail, the largest land-based mollusk on the planet. That's what you're looking at right now, and a beautiful example of one. Just have a look at that face. Isn't that the most incredible thing? That's an eye. They've got four eyes on stalks, retractable stalks. So two long eyes at the end of each stalk, and you can actually see the eye, a black spot at the end of that stalk. That they can retract down that tube, and then two smaller eyes on the end of the two smaller stalks. As you can see there, going through the undergrowth of here and then looking for base. I'm just going to sit down here so that I can show you this whole thing properly. This is fully grown. Has a single muscular foot that runs the length of it and generates mucus which it glides on. To give you an idea of size, have a look at that. Easily as big as my fist. It has a horny beak inside its mouth, which is there. There's a horny beak which it uses to chew with. See, it's just retracted in there. It doesn't like me touching it. Watch the eye stalks come out now towards you. Just to see what's going on. And you'll see the eye come down the stalk and you'll see the little black spot appear at the end of it. Now they do breathe. They have a breathing chamber that we can see here on this side of them that will open inside there. Give it a little bit of time and you'll see that this chamber will open. Gaseous exchange then happens through that chamber. Now Paula, you've just said that you've never seen a snail this big in. You're quite right, Paula. These snails are, they're not rare out here, but to find a snail the size of this is quite rare. This, in fact, is the largest of all the terrestrial snails. So all of the land-based snails that we get on the planet, this giant land snail is the biggest one. Isn't that just the most? There we go. There's the opening. Can't see from here if it's still open. Is it open?
It's closed up.
So it would push out carbon dioxide and then take in oxygen through there. And this muscular foot now is compressed, but probably about double the length of it when it's fully expanded, about this big. I'm going to put him down over here and let's see if he comes out. Let's see. Maybe he goes down there. All right, we're going to send you over to Taylor, who's got that surprise for you.
Look at who it is. It's the Queen herself, Madame Karula, and I have good news for you too, is that both Shongile and Hosanna are here as well. But they seem to have been heading off a little bit further, going on an adventure of their own. So we'll try and get a view of them. You can see Mom is keeping a close eye on her little ones, and I think she's pulling those faces because perhaps they're moving too far away. We're quite a distance away from her, so I know that she's not doing it towards us. And David, I've seen some impala. Yes, look here, straight through those bushes. Can you see between that silver cluster leaf that's dead? If you go straight down there, they are. Look at that. Oh, Karula, I wonder if she's going to see these impala. Now, isn't this exciting? We haven't seen a leopard in ages. And not only did we get to see, of course, the beautiful Nkuhumas, but now we've got our spotted cat. Now, those impala, I don't think they know that she's here, and she's walking straight in that direction now. So this should be quite exciting. She's going to pop out just over here. I'm just going to duck down. She's coming through there, those beautiful spots that camouflage her so well. And I'm glad that the Queen is back and she's going north. What are you looking at up that tree? Now, I think that's where the little ones went. I'm going to go forward because I think I can get a view of the youngsters. Let's have a look. Oh, there they are. I'm going to move up a little bit forward. I'm going to try and predict their behavior here just because otherwise it's going to be quite difficult. I'm so happy to hear that you're all happy. Now she's getting close to these impala. I don't think she's seen them yet. I'm going to go a little bit further forward because we've got a lovely gap. There we go. We've got little Shongile. There she is. Now Hosana, if I'm not mistaken, is further into the thicket. He's just a bit in front. But that looks like Shongile. She's a lot more slight than her big bulky brother. He's almost double her size. He's actually walking in the distance. I don't know if you can see him. There he is. There's Hosana. Isn't that fantastic to see that these beautiful cubs that are 9 months old are happy and healthy? They look stunning. And the impala do not know that this leopard is here. Now, I want to just sit here quietly just for a moment because we're quite close to these impala. So we won't be too quiet. She's coming out, and I hope now she's going to be able to see. Oh, listen. She's growling. I don't think she's growling at us, but we'll just sit quietly. Don't make a noise, Garulo, if they're gonna hear you. David, here they go. She's seen them. Ah, she's been spotted. The impala are now bounding away from her. Oh, and I think that she just unfortunately spotted those impala just too late. And I need to just very quickly reposition. I just want Andrew to be able to see as well. So I'm just going to pull off the road slightly. And then Andrew can take my spot and then he can have a view of the cubs. But that was a pity. But I think she's going to keep pushing on and hopefully keep looking for these impala. Now, sorry, Hunter, you wanted to know how old Karula is. For some bizarre reason, I've completely forgotten, but the age of 11 seems to be sticking in my head. Maybe I'm wrong, maybe I'm right, I'm not sure. 12, I was one off. Thanks, Rebecca. I was close, 12. I don't know why I was always forget that, forget her age. Let me write it down again. Now, those impala are going to run for the hills, of course. And I suspect she's going to have to try her luck for something else. But we know that there's lots of steenbok, lots of komondeiko around. She actually seems to have told her cubs to sit and wait. They were hanging back in the thicket where we saw Shongile and Hosana, which is a good spot. So let's continue forward. Let's try and keep up with Karula. I think this is exciting because she's obviously on a mission this morning. This is amazing. Now I wanna get, I'm gonna go up forward and around. She's just jumped up onto a termite mound. Look at this, look at this. Look how she's using it to conceal herself. Oh, she's such a beautiful leopard. Hello, beautiful girl. Now, if you've maybe just started watching and you haven't seen any leopards since you've been watching Safari Live, now, like I said, Karula's the queen of the northern Sabi San, and especially here on Duma, and she's quite an easy leopard to identify. So what we'll do is when she looks towards us, you must look out for, it's almost a W pattern on her forehead, and I must say thanks again to all the viewers for pointing that out to me. You can actually see it slightly, even when she just turns her head a little bit towards us. And it's always nice to just take notes of markings like this. It becomes quite easy then, the more often you see these individual leopards. But a marking like that is so unique. I've never seen any other leopard with it. Let me go forward again. The impala have all bolted away, so I'm not particularly worried about chasing anything because they're alarmed. They shouted, leopard! in Impala language. So everything that's around here now knows that there's, of course, a leopard here. So she'll have to keep pushing on to further into the drainage systems. Here we go. This is going to be lovely. I just want to move around so I'm not completely blocking her view. But you can see she's looking all around her. She's scanning. Just checking to see if perhaps somebody didn't get the message. What an incredible lady this is. And it's all about being at the right place at the right time when you're on safari. Oh, she's going to come down towards us again. Hello, girl. You see that marking on her head now. Look how she's actually being very placid with us this morning. This is lovely. And she's quite happy to walk past us. We are giving her a bit of space, so she comes towards us if she wants to. And if she shows me any sort of sign of hostility, I will definitely back away. But for the moment, she's lovely and relaxed. We're going to keep following her, of course, and that's what happens when the animals move. We've got to keep moving too. Oh, there's a giraffe. I didn't even see the giraffe. Now, of course, that giraffe has got nothing to worry about. As you can see, Karula's not interested in that big male giraffe. So giraffe, don't worry, you don't have to race on off. She'd never be able to take you down. And that's just because a giraffe is monstrous when it comes to their height. And of course, they weigh about 1.2 tons. So I think that's slightly too large for Madame Karula. Even with the help of her two cubs, I don't think that they would be able to take that down. She's slinking around there. I wonder if she's maybe looking for perhaps a scrub here or something that's sitting, seeking shelter underneath the thorn tree. She knows if she goes for too long without food, her chances of successfully catching something become less and less and less. And especially with two young cubs, she doesn't want that to happen. So even if it is something small, like a scrub hair, just a little power bar, a little snack for her to keep her and her little ones going. Now that giraffe is watching quite curiously. Let's go have a look. So I think we're going to go across to James because he seems to be pretending to be a leopard.
Brian said to me, he said, this tree looks dangerous to climb. And I said, no, Brian, it'll be fine. He said, yes, but I don't think you'll be able to get out of it. And I said, no, Brian, it'll be okay. I'm now convinced that Brian is absolutely correct and that I will probably remain up here until somebody very kind brings me a ladder to get out of the tree. It's not nearly as easy as I thought it was going to be. I used the car to get up. I'm just not sure I'm going to be able to use the car to get out. Why am I up here, you might ask? Well, the real reason is because I'm cold and I wanted to warm up a bit, so I thought I would exercise my muscles by climbing up into this tree. Well, in much the same way, I suppose, as a leopard might. When Karula finally kills something, she will no doubt take it up a tree and place it in much the same way that I'm now hanging.
Oh, wonderful.
That's a fairly morbid thought, isn't it? Yes. Okay. Otherwise, I can tell you about this tree is that there's lichen on it. Can you see the lichen?
I can.
There are two or three different, or probably more than that, but at least two or three different kinds of lichen just on this piece here. And lichen, of course, as we all know now, a symbiosis between fungi and algae. Very nice. And that's probably all I can tell you about this tree. Oh, I can also tell you that it is male. It's a male tree, and we know that because there are no fruits growing on it whatsoever. And therefore, I believe it to be in imminent danger from elephants. They like to eat the bark of these trees, and I think it's largely the male trees that they eat. I don't think they eat the females, and I actually think that were you to do some research on it, and I haven't done any here, I think that they know which trees produce fruit and which don't, and I think they leave the females alone. Right. Brian?
James?
Shall we try and get out the tree?
We can link to Taylor.
I think that's a good idea. Let's link to Taylor while we get out of the tree.
She's going up to the top of a termite mound. I'm going to go forward again and reposition. And she's actually been quite interesting. She's slinked to a very narrow area with lots of thorns. So like I said, I suspect that she is indeed looking for something small to eat. Though if she can catch something bigger, I think she'll go for that too. I'll have a look here. I'm going to poke my nose forward. There she is. But she's definitely on the hunt. Ah. Look at that silly little tree in the way there. How dare it grow there, hey, David? Now, of course, this is something that happens, in that you can't always get the best view. But we'll wait for her. She's not going to stay there for very long. She's scouring the area looking for something to eat. Now, come on, girl, you can do it. Now, catching a leopard hunt live, well, that is something quite special. That doesn't happen every day. I know that Brent was lucky enough, I think it was with Karula, if I'm not mistaken, to see her catch. I think it was a common dacre or a steenbok, something like that. And that is very, very special. But we're going to stick with it. We'll see how long we can stay here. We obviously, none of us have seen leopards for quite a couple of days. So everybody is absolutely desperate to get in on the action. But we'll see if we can hang around and spend a good quality time with her. Oh, I'm so happy that we've seen her. David, when was the last time we saw a leopard? It's been ages. I think the last leopard that we found Tangana, but I was with Brian. Brian and I were driving. We saw Tangana probably about a week ago now. Almost a week ago. It's been ages. She doesn't look thin either. She looks in good condition. And she seems to be doing all right. Every time we see her, she's just finished a kill. And then she seems to get lucky again and catch something else. And her behavior is very much like a leopard that I absolutely love down in the south named Lisbon, where they seem to hunt actually more during the day. And that's also because she's got two young cubs. She tries to keep them hidden at night and in a safe spot. And then, well, today's a perfect day. It's lovely and cool. Look how she keeps walking right near the vehicle. Now, Chelsea, you want to know, at what age will the leopard cubs start joining in on hunts? It should actually be soon. I reckon when they get to just over a year and a couple of months, she's going to start taking them out and teaching them. But I wonder if she catches something like a scrub hare, I wonder if she'll take it back to them and just drop it and let those little cubs have a play. Because she's been looking for something small. She keeps going and checking the thicket areas, sniffing under logs. So it's quite interesting, but every animal is slightly different, the development stages. I'm going to go back again. We need to try and stick with her because it's getting quite thick here. We don't want to lose her, of course. We know where the cubs are at least. And those cubs are old enough now to be viewed without the presence of Karula, of their moms, at about 9 months. That's perfect. And they seem very relaxed with the vehicles as well. Though if we do go back there, we'll just have to give them distance. We don't want to make them feel frightened. Here she is, stopping again. Seeing if she can hear anything. Now it's very dense over there. I can't really see too much further into the thicket to where Karula was. Let's carry on. I'm going to try and roll forward. Let's see if we can get a gap here, David. How's that? There we go. There she is. You see the tip of her tail twitching a little bit? Now, leopards can live a little bit longer than the lions, from what I've seen, and I think the average age of a female leopard is around about 16, 17 years, and I know Elizabeth was actually wondering exactly that. How old can a leopard live for? How long, not how old, how long can a leopard live for? So somewhere around there, but obviously, like I said, it depends on a number of different things. Food availability, the stress that they have, are there lots of other leopards in the area that are competing for her territory? Now, all these things eventually will add up, but she's looking fantastic. You say we came to a conclusion that she's 12 years old. She's looking lovely, fit and healthy. She's got still got a number of years left ahead of her. Now, David, can you see her again? Can you? Where did she go? She's sneaky, this leopard. That's one thing we know for certain, hey David? Just watch these little branches. Karula, where did you go? I'm gonna go forward. I think she may have already gone through here. Okie dokie, we're going to see if we can find her again because she seems to have popped behind some trees. So let's go across to Steph. And it seems as though the wind has died down, which I'm sure he's happy about.
You caught us here looking for the home of the Polyrhynchus ant that we found early on this morning already. Was one of our first things that we saw was one of these little ants. And they like building these thatched, covered nests basically, and I've been looking for one to show you literally from when we started that time. Now the trick is to look for a Polyrhynchus ant, which there are a few of around here. Let me see if I can find one for you. It is at the top of the tree. There's just one at the bottom there. Oh, here we go. Here's one for you on that leaf. That is a Polyrhynchus ant. And then to go to the base of the tree and to look for their thatched home. And that's what I'm trying to show you. Oh, no. I almost thought that this was it here. But this is just some washed dung that had washed in here. Let's take a look around here. I'm hoping to show you one before the end of drive today. Mainly just because they're such interesting things to see, these thatched homes that they have. Now, Big Blue, you've asked if we've seen if we see a spider's nest, if I could show it to you. Absolutely, I'll do that. There's a lot of spider webs around here at the moment, especially the baboon spiders or the South African or Southern African tarantulas. They build these silk-covered holes. I'll see if I can find you one in a bit. Here we've got a foraging party of... Oh, and another... See, when you stick your head down to eye level here, it's amazing what you find. Have a look at this crested locust that's hiding out in this grass cover, looking exactly like a piece of bark. That almost makes me believe that these locusts are geared to hunting in and under specific plants only. Have a look at that. That is a grasshopper from the point of my finger to there, one of the crested locusts. See if I can catch him for you. Have a look at that guy. Amazing. Almost exactly the same color as this. So here's a piece of bark. Have a look here. Isn't that incredible? Hang on, maybe I'll put him down and stop forcing him onto you. Okay. There you go. Amazing. Now I'm convinced that somewhere around here is that Polyrhynchus ant nest, because I'm just seeing more and more of these ants here. The trick is to try and have a look underneath these things and see. Usually, if you want to know what I'm doing between segments, when you're joining us, it's exactly what you're seeing here now. Now, Justin, you just asked me how big ants get on Juma. The biggest ant that we find here is a shiny black ant, probably that long. So about an inch and a half long, about that big is the biggest ant. Actually, no, I lie. The red driver ant is probably the biggest one, and that's double the size. So the red driver ant female is about that long. But I'd say, 2.5 inches would be the biggest ant species that we find here. They're nocturnal. They come out in deep summer, so January, February, March, around about there. And then the one that's diurnal, the daytime one, is probably about an inch and a bit long, about that big. That's the biggest one. Now let's see if we can find a baboon spider's nest. I'm not seeing this Polyrhynchus ant nest, which I'm dearly wanting to show you, but it's not coming out here, hidden from view. Let's see if we can find a baboon spider's hole quickly. Now what we don't want to do is go onto the seep line there, because it'll be too wet to have a burrow. So we want to have a look for it away from where it's wet all the time. And this looks like it's a bit rockier, which will be better to have a look for it. Right, well, I look over here and see if I can pull out a spider's nest. I'm going to send you over to Taylor, who, as far as I know, is trying to find Karula in that thicket.
So we've got Karula again, and she's searching far and wide, still looking for something to eat. You see she is slinking up onto that fallen tree. And that's a very typical thing for these leopards to do, is they use the termite mounds, they use the trees that the elephants have pushed over as vantage points, just to give her a bit of higher ground. Also, well, we know that there's a variety of little creatures that'll be trying to keep out of the wind today. So all the little antelope, scrub hares, ground-dwelling birds, they'll probably all be resting in and around this area. But we need to quickly go around again. I'm going to quickly do a big loop and see if we can get a better view of her. Sneak under here. Just let Rex and jump ahead, Shame. When you're in a big, long vehicle, it makes it a little bit more difficult to maneuver around. Sorry, David, watch your head here. Just a little branch. But we'll take the scenic way around. Like I said, it's easier if we jump ahead of her and get a bigger distance and actually watch us coming and watch her coming towards us. So I think that will be the plan. Let's just go around here. Now I'm just watching to see where she's going, because she could, at the moment she's zigzagging. Oh, we're actually here on Philemon's cut line, eh? Oh, we're close. Okay, so at least we know it's going to open up a little bit now. But she's zigzagging, so I'm having to zigzag after her. That's fine. We're going to come up to a road as well, so we should get some nice open views. And she loves this area. She honestly is often around here. And she loves to hunt here, whether it's just an abundance again, because there's quite a bit of green grass coming through at the moment. Maybe that's why she's hanging around this drainage system. Oh, there she is. Now, I don't think we're going to be able to stay here for too much longer, so let's try get another view of her. Now, Wilma, you're wondering if there's any small rodents around for these cats to eat? Of course there are. From the cane rats to a four-striped mouse, there's shrews, there's all sorts of little things, but they're also hiding away. And as small as what they are, they can also be some of the tougher ones to find. But she's going to pop out just over here, get another view of her. There's that beautiful lady. Hello, girl. Just want to keep my radio up a little bit so I can hear. There are quite a few standbys for the sighting. So basically, they're on hold waiting to come in to see her. She's just sneaking past us again. I think she's going to pop out right next to us.
Yeah, I'm going to go. I'm going to go. I'm going to go.
There she goes, moving into another thicket. Well, we turn that down because I can't speak Shungan fluently. I can't understand Rexon. Her brain is working so hard at the moment. Her senses are on overdrive. Her hearing, her sense of smell, her eyesight. Now she's paused. Both ears pricked forward. It looks like she could have maybe heard something. But there are also a lot of little birds flying around, fluttering through the leaf litter, a couple of scrub robins and things. It could just be that she's hearing. But nonetheless, isn't this just amazing to have a look at one of our favorite leopardesses who has been absent for quite some time? And off she goes again. Now it's getting quite thick. I don't think we're going to be able to navigate through there. And I know that there are a few guides on their way. So what we might do is maybe we'll go back around and have a look at her cubs and have a look. Rex, sorry, I just want to chat to Rex quickly while you look at Karula. You can call the next vehicle. I'll go have a quick look at the Mantuans. Are they coming this way as well? Oh, okay, can I stay with him for a bit longer? Okay, well, it seems like we may be able to stay with these leopards for a little bit longer. So let's just keep up with them, because as soon as another vehicle gets close enough, we're going to have to pull out of the sighting and we're going to have to give them a chance. So let's stick with her. And it seems as though the cubs have moved as well. The cubs have now left their original spot, which is quite dangerous. And they seem to be tailing behind Karula. Can you see her through there, David? There's a little gap. She's moving off. But I reckon... Okay, let's go to James and have a look at what James is doing.
Gobble, gobble, gobble.
If you're wondering what that sound is, well, obviously it's Brian, but it's how he tells me we're live, because where I'm lying here, you can't hear me.
Cutting him out. Just needs to...
How's that? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Where I'm sitting now, I obviously have no communications with the final control, so I get the gobble. Now, this plant that I'm sitting in front of, I was lying in front of, is the disgusting diesel-smelling thing called Clerodendron. And it smells like diesel. I'll pick a leaf so that you can smell it. Obviously, that's not really going to be possible, but I'll help you to imagine it. And then I'm going to pick a flower, which isn't very sensitive of me, but because there are lots of them, I don't mind doing it, because the flowers are very pretty. And before I bring them to you, wait... I want to show you there are two different kinds of millepeds here. Do you see this, Brian?
I do.
Two different species of millipede. Isn't that amazing? And that's not a pill millipede. Pill millipede is what Steph showed you earlier. It's a different kind of a longer millipede. Now, what I want you to do, everybody, is imagine to yourself that you had a leaf like this, and I want you to crush it up. Now, to imagine the smell, what you need to do is imagine yourself going around to the gas cap, if you're in America, otherwise the petrol cap if you're anywhere else in the world. Take it off, stick your nose right in there and go, that is what this leaf smells like. Like a mixture between petrol and diesel. But look at the beautiful flower. Isn't that nice? Long purple pink anthers with the pollen on top and the lovely white flower. And it doesn't smell, which is unusual for a white flower. White flowers often smell. Don't know what pollinates it. But I can tell you that I think that diesel smell is probably a defense against being eaten by, well, anything really. Marvellous. Thank you. Brian gave me a thumbs up there, everybody. I've now lost my microphone. Not my microphone, my... What's this thing called?
Earpiece,
that's the one. Well done, Brian. Okay. Back in the car.
You can link to a millipede.
Okay. Now, this is astounding. Stefan has found a millipede.
Talking about James with these millipedes, have a look at this. Is possibly the biggest millipede I've ever seen. Have a look at the size of that guy. An absolute giant. Now millipedes, of course, they have, he's tasting my finger, they have two sets of legs per segment. So this is a segment, these round things, and they have two pairs of legs, or two sets of legs, for every segment, except the first four segments on the front of the body and the last segment. And there is the urogenital opening. Actually, I think it's just the reproductive opening at the end of the fourth pair of legs. There. When they mate with each other, that is where fluid transfer happens. Right there. This big millipede. Oh, isn't it just fantastic? One of the most ancient animals on the planet. These millipedes, pretty much unchanged for the last couple of hundred million years. Isn't that just incredible? Bulldoze their way through the undergrowth. Very effective shape for pushing pushing undergrowth away from itself. Lots of legs to power that body through. And basically are just detritivores, eating a fungus, an algae, rotting vegetation. Isn't that just amazing? VM is doing a magic job, I'm told, of giving you such a privileged position. Now, he is reversing. I don't know whether it's a he or she. I actually think that they're hermaphroditic, meaning that they can be both male and female, depending on the partner that they find. I mean, why not when you've been around for a couple of hundred million years? And being this size just gives us this lovely view of how it walks. Just try and follow the waves on its legs. Now, Justin, you're 100% right there. This is just such an amazing, complex creature. It really is. I mean, these antennae on the front, they are chemical receptors, basically. Ones that allow this animal to see and perceive its environment. It then has mouth parts right in the front there. You can see it's busy chewing off or tasting my finger at the moment. It's quite ticklish. And you can see how its antennae are just lightly brushing my fingers. Then it's got basically spikes on the end of every foot. Have a look at that. It's now biting me. It's chewing me, actually. It's not painful. It's just weird. Now, Jeffrey, you've asked me how old is this millipede. Jeffrey, I don't actually know how old millipedes can get. I've never read any literature that allows me to say whether this millipede is 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, or 15 years old. Insects can live for a very, very long time. We're looking at some termites and ants living up to 30 years, you know, some baboon spiders, 30 years. But how old this particular one is, I'm not too sure. I mean, it's definitely older than a year. There's no doubt in my mind. As to exactly how old is it, I don't know. A couple of years, probably, get the size. I think on that note, we're going to let him carry on with his day. I'm going to send you over to some hunting birds.
Don't you just count the rings on a millipede to get its age, Brian?
Yes.
So that millipede that Steph had was probably, what, about 40 years old?
Yeah.
Oh, plus minus. Now, this is a hammerkop, of course, everybody, which means hammerhead in the language of Afrikaans. And if you watch it, it has the most infinite patience. Oh, that wasn't very patient at all. But it's looking for frogs. That's the thing that it likes to eat. But the precision with which it's able to move is just quite astounding. And the speed. It will eat frogs as well, but it's largely, at least fish as well, but it's largely frogs. I just think this is fantastic. Now this bird, while we wait to see if it catches anything, builds a nest that weighs in excess of 200 pounds, 100 kilograms. It's a great big mass of sticks and bark and grass and branches. Sometimes if it's anywhere near a lodge, there'll be bits of old shoe, some string, you know, whatever it can pick up at the rubbish dump. And it's this huge mass in the fork of a tree into which a hole is dug, and it's inside the mud-lined chamber that they will give birth. But the temperature is beautifully regulated inside there for the little chicks. Only bird that makes a nest anything remotely the same. 200 pounds. That bird and its mate gathers 200 pounds worth of sticks to build its nest. Let's just see one or two more stabs at the water. But the patience is just so amazing. Completely unlike us, of course. You can't just head off to the pantry to grab something to eat. Hello, Wilma. You say you love this bird. You've never seen one before. I quite like them too, Wilma. But Brian and I were just reminiscing of the tragedies of our childhood when the hammerkop used to come through the Johannesburg Gardens and eat all the fish from the fish pond. It was very distressing, wasn't it, Brian?
It was.
Yes. Beautiful bird. It's got a lovely Shangaan name, and the Shangaan name is Mangonzwana. Mangonzwana. I think it's quite a nice name, don't you, Brian? And the Zulu name is an onomatopoeic one, Itegwane. Itegwane. David, you ask a very valid question. Why on earth would it build such a big nest? I think it's over here in this pond now. Yep, straight in front of us there. David, the only real reason I can think and that anyone else has come up with is that it, well, there are a couple of reasons, but apart from the obvious security advantages of having a nest like that, now you know nothing can get in from either side, it's... For thermoregulation, it's fantastic. It's very, you know, the temperature is very constant inside. I also think that they probably don't build an enormous nest the first time round, but they use the same site again and again and again, and it means that they can use it for a long time. And many birds will then take it over. We had one at Ngala, just near the camp. It was taken over by some giant eagle owls. They used to live on top of it. So I think it's probably thermoregulation and security are the two main reasons it builds a nest like that. But why on earth no other bird has evolved to build a nest like that, I'm not sure. Still looking patiently for frogs. I saw one frog jump into the other pond as this bird flew off, so it missed that one. Marvellous. Let's press on around the corner. Sally, you say this is your 175th bird. That's fantastic, and I'm surprised that you have a bird list that extensive, 175, and we haven't shown you that before. That's very interesting. because they're not that uncommon here. We do see them. 175 is a good bird list. And for those of you who don't know, a lot of our viewers keep bird lists, and all the bird list is a list of list of birds. But it's a list of birds that you've seen on Safari Live. That's why it's called a bird list, Brian. Yes. Right, while my mind slowly atrophies inside my head, let's head across to Taylor and find out if she's still with the Queen.
Now, unfortunately, we had to leave that Karula sighting, but it was very nice, though. Karula's cubs did join up, which was good, because I was a bit worried when they said that those cubs were moving on their own. Now, they shouldn't be doing that. If Mom says stay, theoretically, they should listen and they should stay. So I don't know what caused them to want to try and catch up with her, but they did, and luckily, they reunited, so that was good. Now, we're looking for anything really out here, and it's nice, it's not so cold anymore either. It's quite pleasant. Now, let's have a look here. I saw there's a couple of Gymnogenes or African Harrier Hawks, which are beautiful grey, big eagle-like birds that were flying around. I wonder if we're going to be able to find another one. Oh no, but we've got something else. See who we've got on the ground. Just going to try and get a bit closer. Hi, birdie. Don't run away. There it is. And it's flying. Oh, no. There we go. Oh, and now it just hit away. It looked like a female black-bellied bustard that we very, very quickly had a glimpse of. Let's see if there's any males around here. I'm just having a quick scan. She didn't like us very much. Can you see anything, David? No. Okay. That's all right. It's fine. Now, they're very shy birds. We've seen them. The only time we haven't seen them when they're too shy is, well, we saw those red-crested corons the other day, those males having a bit of a fight. Who have we got here? Let's have a look at this little bird. Can please stay there. It looks like a flycatcher. It's just sitting on this bush wallow. Can you see it, David? Do you see where the dead log is? If you go straight up from it, it's just flown above us. No, I don't know where it's gone now. Okay, well, I don't think we're going to see him. It looked like one of the flycatchers. Okay, there he goes. Seems as though not having any luck with the birds this morning. It's okay, we're allowed to have these days, of course. But I'm not sure which flycatcher it was. I didn't get a great look, but one of them. Let's see what else we can find. There's lots of birds actually chatting around here, so I suspect that there's some form of food party moving through. When I say food party, it's birds that sort of group together that feed at different levels and that are different species of birds too. And it's quite effective for them to move together, because as one is flushing another prey species off the ground, it flies up, and well, somebody that's feeding at a higher level may have an opportunity to grab it. And that's quite nice. And that's what I miss actually about the Eastern Cape the most, is down in the forests and the valleys. And you would just sit there and you would wait, and you'd get flocks of birds coming through and feeding, from the Nerina trogons to chorister robins and all sorts of amazing creatures coming through. Even the flycatchers, some of the paradise flycatchers, those were quite pretty. Now we're just having a quick look. Very quiet. David, where are all the animals gone? They've run away from us. It's not very nice. Oh, and maybe I must also listen to see that we don't bump into Karula again. The rangers would not be very happy with me, because we've already had our turn looking at her. And not one elephant today either.
Just behind the two are right.
Just double checking that we're not in her direct path, but that's fine. It seems as though we're going to miss her. There we go. Someone else is chirping away. It actually seems like the birds are only really out this afternoon, this morning, but they are now also hiding away from us. Let's see if we can spot anybody. David, who have we got sitting up on that dead tree in the distance, on the tippy top branch? Let's see if we can have a look. It's obviously quite difficult. Oh, that's a cool one. This is called a ground scraper thrush. Let's see if you can hear it call. Isn't that such a beautiful call? This is a bird that we don't often get to see. They're around, they're common, but it's normally quite difficult to try and spot them. So this may be a new bird for some of you. And if it is, I'd love to hear what number the ground scraper thrush is. You're welcome to either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Be nice to hear, and it's always good to have a bird list. Now, it sounds like this bird is actually singing a song. Now, rather than doing a territorial call, I think this melody that he's putting out for us is perhaps to try and attract a female. A very, very pretty tune. But typically you'll see these birds not necessarily up in trees, but down on the ground, under the shrubs, moving through the leaf litter, very much like a chicken would, looking for a variety of insects. And one of their favorite foods is the termites. So it's going to have a good opportunity at the moment, especially with the soil being nice and soft and the alates all being released. And perhaps even some of those grasshoppers that Steph has been finding this morning and yesterday. They like to eat those too. This is so beautiful. I'm aching. And it's gone. That was a quick, well, nice little sighting. Normally they actually don't hang around for that long anyway. So that was beautiful. I hope you enjoyed that. And I hope you got a good couple of good screenshots as well. So thank goodness for that little bird popping out. It was getting a bit quiet out there. And on that note, I'm going to try and find something else spectacular before the drive ends. But let's go back across to Steph and see how his morning is going.
Yeah, I think we can, I agree with Taylor. It is a bit quiet out there from a car's point of view because everything is just sort of spread out after all this rain. Just one of those things that happen in summer, and it's to be expected after all the chaos that has been the last couple of months with all the game concentrations around these pans. We've got a herd of impala over here, quite a large herd in actual fact. But we're not going to get too close to them. They're sitting through there. You can see we're not going to move around too much. Oh, they've now just moved off. All right. So we had some impala to show you. They've run away from us. But it has come to that time of the day where we're going to say goodbye and thank you very much for joining us on the walk today from myself and Vian and Herbert. Thank you very much for all your questions and your support, of course. And we'll catch you on this afternoon's PM Safari. Have a nice day.
Right, Brian and I were just discussing, we're sort of kind of on the way home now, and we were discussing what the worst possible breakfast would be. Brian has decided that his worst nightmare would be to get home and find that Brussels sprouts were on the menu for breakfast, and I said, what about to drink, Brian? And he said,
beer.
He said beer and Brussels sprouts would be his idea of the worst possible...
disastrous
I thought steamed courgettes and mint tea would probably be a fairly bland and unpleasant breakfast. There's some dwarf mongoose just to the right hand side. There they are. Yes, Rebecca, mint tea is delicious, but not for breakfast with steamed courgettes. You see how horrified that mongoose looks at the thought. It's going to have a scorpion for breakfast. Or some termites or a grasshopper. In fact, it was so scandalized by the thought of Brussels sprouts and beer for breakfast that it's now going to find something else to eat. And still the wind keeps driving. It really has been, from a climatic point of view, very, well, chillsome out here. Here we go, bit of digging. And of course the mongoose will also eat eggs for breakfast. Well, for lunch as well. They love eggs. Is he digging? I think they're digging for termites. Look at that. This is wonderful. Keep digging. What are you looking for? There's a massive ant there. Look at that ant. I don't know what kind of ant that is. It's not Polyrhynchus, though. That is a monstrous ant. That's at least an inch and a half long. Grief. How cool is that? Right, where's the mongoose now? There it is. Come on, carry on. Come on. A little beetle in front of it now? Which it doesn't seem to have noticed. It will definitely eat beetles. There's the, the ant again. Completely oblivious of each other. That is so cool. There's another... Oh, I'm not going to try and mention it. It was a fly there. Anyway, that was a lovely sighting of ants. There's another one of those huge ants. All right, everybody. You all say you love your Brussels sprouts. Well, you're welcome to all the Brussels sprouts, both my serving and Brian's for breakfast. We're going to find something else to eat. We'll see you this afternoon, hopefully from the tent, and so from the Sunday formal thumb. And me and Brian will hand you over to Taylor for the last few minutes. Bye-bye.
Isn't it always so funny how things like that happen? I'm sure you just saw the little twig moving around like an antenna in the wind. There was a lilac-breasted roller sitting on that branch. That was very funny. Just as Rebecca said, you are live, you are live. It said, right, I'm out, I'm not live anymore. I'm going off to do something else. My goodness, today has been an amazing day, but also a tough one. Just with trying to get the animals to hang around for long enough. They've been quite sneaky. But I suppose that's the joy of being out here in the wild, is that you never know what's around the next corner. And well, you never know how long something is going to hang around for. Well, let's see if we can find another bird. I'm actually enjoying the birding this morning. It's been wonderful. I've seen the new cuckoo, which is a new one for me, of course. Oh, Chris Rogue, you were hoping that indeed the cuckoo we saw was going to be the common cuckoo, which it indeed is. And that is apparently number 247 for you. So congratulations. That's quite a good number to see. What I'll do is I need to tally up how many birds I've seen. I've seen a couple of new ones around here. But I don't actually have a massive bird list. I must be just shy of 400 birds. Not too many. Maybe a bit more than that now. I'll have to have a look. But then also some of the birds I've seen, it's not just a South Africa bird list. It's also got to do with, well, Zambia. Oh, there's some impala. Hello, guys. Let me just go back a bit. Sorry, I rolled a bit too far forward. There they are. Are they watching us? It seems as though they're giving a stare down. Oh, and I believe that Brian's bet on when the first impala lamb will be born is apparently today. That'll be quite exciting. I actually don't mind who wins this bet. I just want to see a tiny little impala lamb. But the thing is that we need to not check in these open areas. We actually need to start checking for single impala that are hanging around in the thicket. And I think then we'll have a good chance. But you can see they're looking round. And I'm sure that their mammary glands are nice and swollen now too. Getting ready for the arrival of their little lambs. Come on, girls. And I remember the famous line that Byron said. He drove up to a herd of impala, and I'm sure some of you will remember this. And he then asked them, "Do any of you feel like giving birth today?" And I thought that that was quite funny. As if any of them would actually answer. It would be nice, of course. But unfortunately, the time has come where I'm going to have to say goodbye to you, but it's been absolutely wonderful this morning from Karula, and to see that her cubs are healthy. We need to find out where the missing Kahuma cub is, but we'll come to you. We'll figure out what the bottom of that is. But thank you to everybody who has worked on this wonderful production, and we'll see you in the afternoon for the Sunset Safari. For myself and David, have a lovely day. We're going to go and have a big breakfast.